Chris, that's way too much.
I would like to call to order the meeting of the Twin Falls City Council for Monday, April 17th. We're about 3:33, and we have convened here at the council chambers, and we are going to now go and tour the public safety building in the future city hall, and then we will come back and continue our agenda at 5 o'clock. Chris Talkington.
Yeah, I wonder if it's a dangerous sign the council should be aware of that only the city staff have heard helmets.
I'm really worried myself.
We good, Chair? So I'd like to reconvene the Twin Falls City Council meeting for Monday, April 17th. We did convene the meeting at 3:30 this afternoon and then took a tour of our new public safety building and the future city hall. So now we are back here at the council chambers and ready to go with our 5 o'clock agenda. So the first item is the Pledge of Allegiance. For any of you wishing to join us, please rise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We do have a quorum of the council. All seven members are here this evening. Mr. Rothweiler, do we have any amendments to the agenda?
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, there are no amendments this evening.
Thank you. We do have one proclamation this evening, and I actually read and presented this proclamation earlier today for the Junior Achievement of Idaho board meeting that was happening in Twin Falls, but I will read it for the record this evening. Proclamation, Financial Literacy Month. Whereas financial literacy is essential to the financial stability of all Idahoans, and whereas given the stability and strength of Twin Falls, our citizens are energized and engaged in growing our economy, improving our communities, and turning their attention toward planning and managing their financial futures. And whereas it is critical that Idaho's citizens make well-informed, educated decisions in planning for their financial futures through appropriate savings and investing habits, and whereas Junior Achievement of Idaho seeks to increase the financial capability of young Idahoans using proven programs and caring volunteers from the community, and whereas Junior Achievement of Idaho strives to educate Idahoans on the wise use of credit and importance of budgeting on a variety of critical financial decisions, including the use of consumer credit, securing a home mortgage, and paying for college. And whereas Junior Achievement of Idaho educates the next generation of Idahoans to be better informed investors, consumers, borrowers, and supporters of their households for now and into the future. And whereas it is everyone's responsibility to learn the basic facts of investing in consumer credit, take charge of their money, realize the importance of saving for their family's future, and understand that it is never too late or too early to save and invest. And whereas during the month of April, Junior Achievement of Idaho, state and federal agencies, consumer groups, the media, and the financial industry will join together to conduct educational events through the media and in communities and schools to illustrate the importance of personal financial ownership. Now, therefore, I, Sean Berriger, Mayor of the City of Twin Falls, Idaho, do hereby proclaim April 2017 to be Financial Literacy Month, and I encourage all citizens to remember their personal responsibility to learn the basic facts of investing in consumer credit, take charge of their money, realize the importance of saving for their family's future, and understand that it is never too late or too early to save and invest and to take advantage of educational opportunities to learn more about financial planning. The end. So again, I presented that today to the Magic Valley Board of the Junior Achievement of Idaho, who are out doing these kinds of training sessions in our schools throughout the Magic Valley. So great group. Next is the opportunity for general public input. If there's anyone here from the public wishing to address the council on an issue that is not on the agenda, now's your chance to come forward. Do we have some folks signed up? Thank you, sir. All right, so Eric is wanting to speak on an item later. So I see, is it Doug? I can't read the last name there. On Knoll Ridge Road? Nope. Okay. Todd Anderson, you wanted to speak on anything that's on the agenda? Nope. Mr. Edwards, did you want to give public input?
No, but I think he's
okay, you can come on forward. So just to clarify our procedures, state your name and address, whether you're a resident or property owner in the City of Twin Falls. and then proceed with your input, and we'll limit it to just 3 minutes if you could, please.
Sure. My name is Linda Rasmussen. We own our home on 1221 Spruce Avenue in Twin Falls. I wanted to just mention from last week when we were here, and it was never brought up about vetting and the whole issue of the refugees. Vetting never came up, and so I thought of saying something last time, and I didn't do it, so here I am. Just to say that I think that's a very important thing that we have to consider, that not everyone has the same intentions when they come here. And so it's important that we would be able to tell that by vetting people. And so I think that's just something very important. I don't think that we can overlook that, how that would be. A lot of people were talking last time about the good friendships that they have made and so forth with good quality people. That's a wonderful thing. But when we have some people who don't have that same design, they would rather have us follow their Sharia law. I think that's important. Remembrance. So, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Rothweiler.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, I might ask for just maybe a point of, an opportunity to offer information as it relates to the resolution that is blended of a welcoming resolution as well as a Safe Cities welcoming, you know, resolution, trying to blend those two together. With the members of the audience that are here now, I thought I might give an update for the record in terms of what the staff's plan is moving forward so that if people have to leave early or are not able to stay for the duration of the meeting, we can get the information out. Our understanding by staff is that the council has asked for the staff to work collaboratively with those who have spoke in this process or who might have some sentiment or desire to engage in the process by incorporating their citizens in a balanced, resolutioned and approach. We have gone through the process and we're reviewing the record of the meeting, the audio. We would ask individuals who want to share direct feedback into that process that they reach out to us at city staff, and they can do that by reaching Josh Palmer directly. We're asking them to do that because rather than us capture a bunch of information and contact information, we're asking those who are truly interested in that process to share their thoughts with us as we kind of go forward to create that balanced resolution that was requested by the council. Our current schedule, and we're asking for a little bit of flexibility, is that we as a staff will present a draft resolution for your review, which may require redrafting or tweaking at the May 1st council meeting is the current plan that we've set forward. Depending upon the amount of editing, whether or not staff even gets our first shot right, our intent would be 1 to possibly 2 weeks later having the final resolution available to the council for inspection and consideration, hoping that in that second review we would have moved that forward. We recognize that the community wants us to act expeditiously, as there have been 2 presentations made by the city council in the prior 2 weeks. And so we're doing that the best that we can. But again, in order for us to have that complete resolution, we do need the assistance of those who are desiring to participate in the process to reach out to Josh Palmer and to share those thoughts. And if people are looking for email addresses, we can certainly provide that, but they're also accessible by the city's webpage.
Thank you, Travis. Suzanne Hawkins.
Travis, just a point of clarification. We are doing a proclamation and not a resolution. Is that correct? I thought we were working on a proclamation.
So the request last week was actually for a resolution.
Wow, I missed that. I apologize. I thought it was just a proclamation.
The motion said resolution.
Yeah.
The motion that was, I believe, we'll go back and look, but I believe the motion referred to a balanced resolution.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Chris Dockington.
I think it's important to keep in perspective, though, that last week, 19 people came here speaking specifically about a welcoming community, 4 against it. That's 85%. So no matter how much new input you may solicit, I think the preponderance of the people that took the effort and the time to show up cannot be minimized or swept under the rug. people were overwhelmingly endorsive of a welcoming community.
Is it too late for the public to speak?
No, I'll get right to that in a moment, so once we finish this item up. So is there anything else for Travis on this item? So, Mr. Edwards, you're welcome to address the council now.
Terry Edwards, Jerome, Twin Falls. First of all, I'd like to say Mr. Talkington keeps going back to how many people were here supporting it. You guys did a phenomenal job. You orchestrated the whole procedure last week and in bringing on Boy Scouts. Why didn't you bring in pictures of suffering little children? I mean, I can't believe you guys orchestrated that kind of thing.
Okay, Mr. Edwards. Mr. Edwards.
Just a minute.
Excuse me, sir. This is my meeting.
Okay, it's
Will you hold on for a moment, please? I am not going to sit here and listen to you make false allegations of
no,
us.
So if you'd like to give us... You brought... It's not an allegation. It's a fact. You brought in Boy Scouts here, right?
I didn't orchestrate anything.
Yes, you did. I have documentation to show you orchestrated it. What I'd like to say
okay,
also,
if you have some public input that's
yes,
for the
I
good
do.
Of the city, please provide
input.
It.
Instead of submitting my information to this gentleman here, that I would like to have some input on this resolution, I've already submitted a proclamation.
Which we have.
Okay,
and I'd like you to consider that
in relation to this resolution.
Which is exactly what Mr. Rothweiler just said.
I'm not going to give him my information. He's got the proclamation. He can incorporate those points.
Right, which is what he said he would do.
Okay, well, that's fine. And I want to be sure that I don't have to call him and beg for him to contact me or give him my contact information.
Okay.
So what I'm thinking is that once you blend all this stuff together, it's still going to be a sanctuary city precursor. That's what you guys are headed for. This is not a welcoming community. We have Planned Parenthood operating right here in town. We have all these things going on here, and you're not protecting the citizens. You're bringing in outside people that you don't know where they're from. They can't be vetted. It's been documented that they can't be vetted. And you're turning them loose on the city. This is not a welcoming city. To you, it may be, because you live in an elite area and have elite associates. The common people here aren't being treated fairly. And that proclamation doesn't need to be in place, or doesn't need to be a welcoming city proclamation. It's ridiculous to even think of one. So here you folks are considering this thing, trying to make it look like, oh, well, everybody come here to Twin Falls. What are we going to do when we get here? The police department is not adequate. There's crime going on here that's not being reported. They don't even put it in the paper anymore because there's so much of it. The little girl that was raped, it's been admitted by the defendants that they did that. And you guys denied it all the time that we were reporting
that. Are you done with your input on this item, Mr. Edwards?
It's a fact.
Are you finished?
Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else from the public who wishes to address the council on an item that's not on the agenda this evening? Please come forward.
Hi, I'm Bethany Rasmussen, and I'm a resident of Twin Falls. I was slightly confused last week, like I had stated before, that I didn't know what exactly a welcoming city was. I talked to probably 30 people this week just asking them, did you hear Twin Falls is becoming a welcoming city? Do you know what that means? Nobody had any clue. So I would love to get some information on this to be able to figure out exactly what a welcoming city entails. I know that you guys have voted that we will become one, but I don't think that the public has really had a whole lot of knowledge what goes into that, what the results are of that, what exactly that means for our community. And so I would really like to be able to have that knowledge, and I would imagine since you voted on it, you have some idea what you want it to be. So is there a way that we can find out some information on that? I guess it's not question and answer time, yeah. But.
So I would share with you that the entire presentation last week was a request from members of the community
okay.
asking us to consider adopting a resolution that emphasized the welcome. I'm going to say the welcoming nature of our city. So welcoming city isn't like a thing. It's not a label. It's not a program. It's not a designation. It is simply using the word that as a city, we are welcoming of others, was what the request was to us. So as the proclamation is drafted by city staff, which is what the council voted on, or the resolution, which is what the council voted on and directed staff to do last week, it will come back before the council. There'll be a draft copy that's provided in our agenda packet, as it is every week, for public inspection and participation.
Okay.
We'll continue to have that conversation, and then, as Travis stated earlier, after a week or two, that would likely come back to the council for our consideration. So again, welcoming city isn't some sort of designation by anyone. It
is a resolution. So what
it would
be
a resolution of us saying that as a community, we welcome others, and it will have verbiage in it that does that. But it's not a program or a designation by anyone.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Is there anyone else who wishes to address the council? Seeing no one, we will move on with the agenda. The first item for consideration is consent calendar. Chris Talkington.
I have a question to the city manager. Under the payables this time, Star Corp, we paid nearly $555,000 for our projects. Two questions. About what percent progress are we, and are any issues of substance that have come up since the last month's paying? I don't expect you to have an exact percentage, but I don't want to wait to the end to discover issues. I want to have progress reports on a regular basis.
And so what I might ask, Councilman, is that I know Jason Derricott is going to be talking later on in this project, and he's going to share out specifically where we're at in terms of progress and where that progress payment reflects. At this point in time, we are not seeing any unforeseen issues that would cause any deviation from the total budgets that have been approved by the City Council. So if we're looking at the financial aspect of it, the financial aspect is completely on target. Jason and his team with the folks from both Hummel and then Clint Sievers, who's an architect on the project, are going to be able to talk about the scope and the phase of the projects and where they're at in terms of completion. And then if they don't complete that or answer that question to that satisfaction during their presentation, we'll be in a position to also share that information.
So it's fair to assume that we're not dipping into reserves yet in any category that you're aware of, or is that something that...
So the entire project is paid for with reserves, and so we're using cash reserves to fund the entire balance of the project. And so in terms of dipping into reserve, that's what we have done.
Thank you.
Ruth Pierce.
So I would move that we approve the consent calendar.
Second.
Motion by Ruth Pierce, seconded by Greg Lanting to approve the consent calendar. Is there any discussion? Suzanne Hawkins.
Sorry. Before we vote on that real quick, can we, I see Jackie, can we just have her real quick hit that master plan schedule that's in that set of elections, or do you want to do that later? Because that's for public information, I know.
We certainly can run through that real quickly now.
Jackie, on our consent calendar is the transportation master plan schedule that we're getting ready to vote on, and I was just wondering if you'd real quick remind everybody of the dates and times for that so it's on the public so they can hear what's going on. Thank you.
Okay, so the transportation master planning process has kicked off, and we've established existing conditions data, and we're doing some modeling to try to talk about what happens in the future. There are several components of the transportation master plan that are not exactly capacity and maintenance related issues. Those have to do with elements like sidewalks, illumination, truck routes, bike paths. So tomorrow night at all of these, we're going to have a few outreach meetings, and they're going to be held at the City Council chambers. Tomorrow night at 5:30, we will have a meeting to talk about bike routes and paths, as well as any illumination considerations that anyone wants to bring up. So we'll produce the draft bike plan map, and we'll start from there. You know, does this still look good? Does this work for the community? This was a result of a prior community effort, and where do we go from here? Same thing with illumination. We had some information on what those, you know, what kind of what people wanted. I don't think the outreach was sufficient, and we want to try to get a little bit more for how dark is dark and how light is light. After that, from 7:30 to 9, we intend to talk about truck routes through the city. Okay, our current code says that if an entity has been able to obtain a permit, that they can drive anywhere in town. So residential streets, cul-de-sacs, you know, running down Canyon Springs Grade, some of these roads are not where we want to have trucks driving in town. We also want to build our roads to the depth that they need to be built for the loads that are going to be on them. So that's the nature of that conversation. On Wednesday night from 5:30 to 7, we'll be talking about sidewalks and once again also doing some outreach on illumination. Sidewalk conversation is, where are they? Where do they need to be? Should they be attached to the curb? Should they be pretty? Should they be easy to traverse? You know, whatever. So the sky's the limit on the sidewalk conversation.
Thank you.
And that's it for our near term. So we'll have a larger open house in May, June, and then probably some more outreach throughout the summer. Okay. We have a website for the project, so people can chime in and provide comments, even if they haven't been able to talk to a person or come to a meeting. And they can always call me at the engineering office or Rob Ramsey at Civil Science to talk about what they want to.
Nikki Boyd.
Jackie, can you tell us what that website is? That was quick.
No, actually, I cannot. So I'll have to get back with you on that. The theory is that the link is up. And
it's on there.
That's not the right site.
Oh.
That site went down the day after we put it up, and there's a new link that's established on the city's website. So
if
we can get onto
citizens want to go to tfid.org and look for that
link,
okay.
That'll redirect them.
Perfect. Fantastic.
Great.
Thank you.
Sorry about that.
No, thank you.
Anything else on the consent calendar? Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Suzanne Hawkins.
Yes.
Nikki Boyd.
Yes.
Sean Berriger.
Yes.
Chris Talkington.
Yes.
Greg Lanting.
Yes.
Christopher Reed.
Yes.
Ruth Pierce.
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0. The first item for consideration is a presentation of design awards to Jay Bryan and Gene Roberts for their Archway Project Design submittals. We have Kathy Marcus.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Last time I was here presenting on the archway, we presented the overall design of the archway. Today, we want to recognize those citizens who presented concept designs to us. We had 15 to 20 people, different people who presented their archway designs, and we selected two of them that we felt really worked with what we wanted, and we combined both of their designs to create the archway design that you saw when we were here last. Part of the design, when we submitted it out, we told everyone that they'd get a pizza party if they won, because we didn't know if it was going to be a school class or what size group it was going to be. Middlecoff Auto has instead given us a check for $250 for each individual, and they can have a really large pizza party, or they can go buy whatever they would like with that. So I wanted to present the designs and show you the different concepts and actually present the awards to both Gene and Jay afterwards. And I'm hoping Gene and Jay are here. Gene's Jay. Okay, and Gene.
Surprise, Kathy.
Oh, you're Gene?
I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Gene Roberts. Most of you probably know me for the last 50 years as Paula Sinclair. If you will excuse my petty fraud, I worked very hard to keep my personality out of the design deliberations.
Nice.
So. You succeeded.
Okay, so let's show you Gene's design. You are tricky.
That's awesome.
So this is the design that she created. And, did you want to want to expand on that? I want to see your cash the check.
Trust me, I will be happy to endorse it over to the Twin Falls Community Foundation Archway Fund. It will be the first, the beginning of that fund. I didn't do this for any kind of a prize. And by the way, Kathy, we really need to thank Greg Middlecoff. He was so quick to realize that an artist should deserve a prize, and he got his checkbook out so quick. And I just really think that Greg deserves that appreciation. It's only the right side of this. The left side was just to show structure. The right side that the committee liked was to try and duplicate the look of the canyon walls. That's all.
Jean, I think I can.
I'm so excited, okay. Paula.
Thank you,
Seriously,
Paula.
Seriously, you fooled all of us.
Yes, you did. I had the worst time knowing whether or not she was going to be here because it was a phone number that I kept calling and leaving messages on, and I was like, I hope this person shows up.
That secret phone number, huh?
Ruth, you told me you knew where all the bodies were buried, and I said, I think there's one you don't know about.
I you're right.
And we're also privileged to have Jay Bryan here today. Jay's design. And Jay, you
want to
let them know where you...
Basically, I just wanted to incorporate what's important to Twin Falls. One of the things that makes Twin Falls connect with everybody is the bridge. Mm-hmm. Primary key, important part of Twin Falls. Then what I did, I started with, when we started coming to Twin Falls before it was settled, was the covered wagons. Then it went from that to Pony Express and to... bringing people from the east to the west with not only covered wagons but with stagecoach. Then the farming opportunities that is here, I still feel we're a rural town, working with horses. Then the first tractor in Twin Falls, and then those current tractors we have here in Twin Falls. And so I just incorporated that into making people know that we have a little bit of history here.
Jack. Ruth Pierce.
So Nikki and I were part of this committee, and it was a really tough thing. That there were a lot of great designs. You fooled me, sister. But I think we came up with something super nice, and we're pretty excited to get this thing rolling. We've actually contacted some foundations, and we're looking at getting some donations. And also one of the foundations stepped up and said, not only would we like the reader boards on here, we'd like to sponsor reader boards at every end of town to help with Amber Alerts and, you know, whatever it is, construction, accidents, whatever. And so we're pretty excited about that. But we had a really great committee.
So this, for those of you who weren't present last time, this is the final project, and I wish the picture was a little better. But as you can see, it has Jay's bridge with the writing of the Twin Falls, and then it incorporates Jean's Paula's rock coming up out of the canyon. And Paula had one more comment.
I asked Kathy if I could make a suggestion. There is a very, very meritorious part of Jay's design that the committee did not include in our final proposal. The silhouettes that Jay has done of the transportation are a very fine piece of art. And I would suggest to you that the city should negotiate with Jay Bryan to purchase that. It can be laser cut out of steel. It's a flat sculpture. And at least at this point, we have a perfect place for it along the northwest edge of downtown Commons. I make this suggestion because I don't think that the city owns the rights to it just because it was part of a submission. And that point was not made clear in the proposals for the art. But I do think that it is so meritorious that I strongly suggest that the city negotiate with Mr. Bryan to purchase that as a separate piece of art, possibly to be included in the downtown Commons.
And one of the reasons that we did not include all that beautiful artwork on the archway was because we wanted the focus to be not on the art, but on the signs. And we thought it might be a little bit too busy if we had everything there. It's beautiful.
Thank you, Kathy. Chris Talkington.
And as I recall, about $43,000 was coming out of city coffers, but $5,000-$6,000 of it is to be raised through private donations. And do we have a timetable, kind of a goal to set?
Yes. So we are, the bids have come in an estimated $225,000.
Okay.
$225,000. So the city has donated or allocated $43,000. Mitch and I went to the county and made a proposal to them. We've gone to, what, probably a half a dozen foundations / nonprofits.
We have already submitted three one-step foundation requests, and we've submitted two more that are two-step requests that we are hoping to get invitations to June in-person presentations.
So we know for sure we have one invitation. I just found out today.
Okay, that's
so, yeah.
And then I have, I'm partway through another four.
Okay,
large ones.
Perfect.
So the goal is for the committee to raise the funds through these different activities and through contacting different businesses and community.
Well, and our goal would be to have it done by October, end of October, when
everything else.
Yeah.
Excellent.
That's our goal.
Thank you.
And thanks again to both Jay and Paula for their
Gene.
Thank you, Kathy. Next is a request to support the preliminary design for the intersections of Shoshone Street at 4th Avenue East and 6th Avenue East. And we have our city engineer, Jackie Fields.
As you know, we entered into a state-local agreement with Idaho Transportation to improve the intersections along Shoshone Street. Two of the intersections are located right next to City Park. The preliminary design for the improvements, so the project is going to upgrade signal equipment, fix some ADA approach problems, and address some potential left turn movements. There's about two-thirds of the intersection of 6th Avenue North and Shoshone Street. You can see the Rose Gardens at the courthouse, the City Park, the Clinic Building, and First Christian Church. This design for left-turn pockets is identical on the other side of the street and is the same layout as you would see at 4th by the Methodist Church and First Fed and so on. So this block of City Park is 600 feet long, and a total of 190 feet of removed parking seem to be measurable and on each side. So I had a conversation with the Parks and Recreation Commission about access to the park, the importance of modifying the intersection to improve it so that we have better timing, and how deep that left turn pocket needed to be. Staff had done some review on the project and believed that maybe that turn bay could be a little bit shorter. Parks and Recreation Commission supported the design as presented. Then on Thursday, I had the same conversation with the Traffic Safety Commission, and they were also made aware of the information that had been presented to the Parks and Rec Commission, as well as Parks and Rec's recommendation. And we also had the discussion about the queue length for the left turn pocket, and they supported the design as presented. And so with both commissions supporting the design as presented, I wanted to come to the council and let you know that this is what was happening, and ask that you consider supporting that as well. If you felt that perhaps 200 feet is a little bit long on each side, The project can easily reduce this portion of the turnpocket from 100 feet to 50 feet, which stores about 2.5 cars, for at least the short term, and without violating any other rule or, you know, making my life difficult for making the project progress towards bid. So,
you say it can be done to shorten it?
It could be. So if the commission's recommended the project as designed, it is possible to reduce that turnpocket from 100 feet down to 50 feet, and then the rest of it stays the same. So this taper length is a good taper length for, because it's only 25 miles an hour, and you know, we know people are not usually driving 25 miles an hour there. So having the decision-making process and the opportunity to get in here in this area is prudent to leave it as it stands. So, but the actual storage, which is from here, over to here, could be reduced to 50 feet if you so chose. So the, yes?
But that doesn't necessarily, does that pick you up parking spaces? It doesn't,
yes.
Does it?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it adds back.
How many?
About two on each side.
Two on each side.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. I have a couple of lights here for questions. If you're ready, Greg Lanting.
Jackie, my question is actually up at 6th, or actually 4th. I had people concerned about the access to the park there, or part of those corners are not wheelchair accessible, is what they say. Maybe the part over by the First Methodist, and I'm wondering if that's going to be remedied with this project, or is it just the turn lanes?
This project will address the ADA approaches on all the corners of all the intersections. So if they don't absolutely meet the code right now, they'll be improved.
It's one of those is where somebody had asked me, and I just hadn't seen you since they asked me about
this
it.
This location right here is difficult, and it is a high back curb.
Okay. Thank you.
Suzanne Hawkins.
Jackie, how many total spaces or parking spaces are we going to lose if we do it as designed?
2, 4, 8.
So, across the face of City Park, 18, 9 on each side.
Okay.
So then when you cross the street onto in front of County Courthouse, it would be the same, 9 at each intersection.
So 36 total.
Yes, and then. When you're on the non-park locations, there are also parking stalls that go away. That's about 8 each.
Okay. So when we have major events in that area now, do we get complaints from that neighborhood for people parking in front of their houses, businesses? I mean, what is the general feeling of people that live in that area about maybe having people pushed off in front of homes if they can't park in front of the park to get in? Do you know?
I don't know.
No discussion
on that. We haven't received complaints in the past about crowded parking times, you know, and we're running the basketball games in the street and people are pushed out into the neighborhoods. We haven't received parking complaints then. So we didn't do outreach beyond going to Parks and Rec and Traffic Safety.
Okay. Just because I'm on the library board, I know when we do things, people tend to fill up the library parking lot, and that becomes kind of a difficult issue sometimes. So I didn't know if we had any comment from any of the extra businesses or groups in the area. Thank you.
Christopher Reed.
Jackie, how often are those parking spots used? I mean, when I drive down that street, there's rarely ever anybody parking there, maybe one or two cars.
Thursday nights. Western days.
Several times a year for very popular events that are held at the park, every single spot is used.
Okay.
They're very coveted during Thursday night conferences.
Yeah.
Concerts.
So, okay. You know, there are times when...
So once or twice a week and then a
couple
times a year.
Right around the park, there will be quite a bit of usage. This is not necessarily comfortable parking in here. Okay? And same thing with down by First Christian Church in the clinic. It's uncomfortable to park there, and some of it is posted as no parking already. So these parking spots, all the diagonal parking on 4th and 6th will stay in place. So they will tend to be more utilized than they have in the past, potentially. So, I did not monitor the park and then the environs to try to determine how much parking is used all the time.
Okay.
So this is anecdotal.
Okay. And if we shorten it to 50, we're gaining four or two more in each area?
Two more on each side of the city park.
Mm-hmm.
And on each side of the street.
So eight total overall.
And then we would potentially also gain a little bit more parking right here in front of, well, actually in front of this building next to the Methodist Church and in the building next to the First Christian Church to the north, northish.
So that would be 10 total spots we'd be gaining if we shorten it?
4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 20. 14, 16.
So we'd be gaining 20. Only losing.
Yeah. Well, but that 20 isn't 16, out of the 36, because 36 you're only counting
so
in the frontage of the park.
Oh, okay, that's where we're talking.
The 36 you're talking about between 4th and 6th.
Both
picking up 20 is between 2nd and...
Is that correct?
3rd, or 3rd and 3rd.
Okay.
And it's not 20, it's 16. Right. So it's actually 16.
16, yeah.
8 of which would be in that block.
The next block over.
That's accurate.
Okay.
Chris Talkington.
Well, my circumstantial observation is that I don't see a lot of stacking on left-hand turns. I usually see maybe one person trying to do a left-hand turn but backs up other people. What do you think of the idea that we go for the shorter distance, 50 feet or whatever you said, keep yours close track on the data, maybe, I don't know, personal observations or your automatic counter to see if that actually helps relay the situation. I'm just not sure that, with the exception of a few concerts, I don't see a lot of 6 or 7 cars all trying to do a left-hand turn. So I would favor doing the abbreviated left-hand turn bays for a period of observation. Because it looks like it's primarily just striping and signing.
So you started with a question. Do you want me to answer it? Or do you? I mean, I apologize, really.
Yes, please.
Okay. Sorry. Thank you very much for letting me answer that. So the queue is not substantial for the left turn movement, and the reason I believe that the queue is not substantial is that people can still weave around potential left turn movements. So having refuge is handy. Staff had offered to the both commissions the opportunity to utilize a 50-foot storage queue because we think that that would work. So to answer the original question, yeah, that's absolutely an opportunity, and it can be managed quite well. And I apologize for the way I asked that question.
Greg Lanton.
Well, I kind of agree with Chris trying to 50, and just because the Parks and Rec Commission and the Traffic Safety Commission is not going to get the phone calls after the first Thursday night conference concert. Excuse me, whenever all those coveted spots are gone. So I would like to try the 50 myself. If I go to a major event there when the parking's full, usually when I'm there, First Fed and Title Fact and all those places are closed. So I just and there those parking lots are always wide open. So I just park in there, but I realize I can walk a little farther than others might be able to. And so those things. Also, I have concerns if we do the full length on 4th headed. What is that? Northeast. That's an apartment building behind the church there, and I think they're pretty limited on their parking already, what they have available to them. So if we take away all of the rest of, from their building all the way to Fourth, I'm pretty sure that we're just going to push more of them over, because I've noticed now most of them are parking. Those two cars that are down on Fourth by the park, I think that's where they're parking now, and I guess that's legal parking for them. And so I'd hate to see lose even more spots. So now I would be in favor of dropping it down to 50 feet. And like Chris said, watch it and see how it works.
So the easiest time for us to change striping is after a seal coat, so that opportunity presents itself regularly. Mm-hmm. Thanks to you for that.
All right. So,
Suzanne Hawkins.
Thank you. Jackie, any of the parking places around City Park, are any of those handicapped accessible now? Do we have reserved parking, or are we allowed to do that in that area? I'm just thinking with Greg and the concerts, I know we have a lot of elderly that have a rough time, and if we had some way of...
No,
we have a lot of elderly people that attend those concerts. I attend them. Sorry, I didn't mean to come out that way. But I just think if we had some reserved parking for people who needed it for those events, that would help some of the heartburn.
So I have no idea how many ADA spots we have striped on the street around City Park. I do know that we have striped ADA spots in other locations on the street, usually when there's no other opportunity for those people. The advantage is obviously that someone who needs the placard has the spot, and the disadvantage is that if they're, you know, many times we see the spots without people in it. So
right.
We can, you know, if the council would like us to look into figuring out how to put something there next to a ped ramp, we can certainly do that.
It was just a thought off the top of my head. I'd like to make sure that some of those that want to attend those events have access to it.
So I believe there are some on Hanson Street, at the where the road comes in behind the restrooms. I believe there are a couple of handicap spaces there that are painted on the on-street parking.
Okay.
And then you have them across at the library as well, and then over at the funeral home.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. I'd never paid attention to it. It just kind of a light bulb went on. Yeah. Thank you.
Ruth Pierce?
So, I honestly, Sean, I don't think there's a lot of handicap, and we may want to look at that on the street. But what I wanted to say is I really hate to see us lose parking spots, especially 2.5 cars-ish. And I go down that road like 10 times a day, almost, not quite. And I've never had an issue of three people stacking up to turn left. Honestly, so I think we ought to shorten it myself.
Chris Reed?
One last question. So if we were to shorten it, find out a year later we need to lengthen it, what's the cost? I mean, I know that we just said striping and signs, but what kind of cost are we looking at having to do it twice?
We give you a gallon of paint and a paintbrush.
Your kids, all your kids.
So... cost is really modest, so we would try to do that. We'd try to make a change after a seal coat, because if we're trying to remove the pavement markings, that's somewhat ineffective, and it tends to be a little bit more expensive. So extending the queue may or may not result in an additional thermoplastic pavement marking arrow, and then the paint is really not a large sum of money.
Okay.
You know, we're talking under $500.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Nikki Boyd?
Jackie, I've had the privilege of hearing this presentation now three times. I liaisoned to both of those committees, and I sat through that, and, you know, I listened to what they had to say. And I was wondering at the time why they weren't open to 500. And...
50.
To 50. That's a lot of cars. And the only thing I can think of is, after hearing the discussion tonight, is we're going to lose 18. We were talking 18 parking places, and if you go half of that for stacking, you don't gain 9 of them back. it's not an even 50-50. And so for four parking places, they were thinking is it's better to have more if we're only going to gain the parking places. But I have to say, I agree with the 50 feet. After hearing this, and I would be in favor of just 50 feet and extending it if we needed more at this point.
So I do know we have a member of the audience who wanted to speak on this issue as well. So if there's nothing else from the council, I will invite him up. Eric Smallwood.
Hi, Eric Smallwood, 255 6th Avenue North. I live right by the intersection that we're talking about. And I'm not up here to argue the intersections of 6th and 4th and Shoshone don't have a problem. They obviously do, which is why we're here tonight. There have been crashes. What I'm proposing is the city look at it as a more viable solution that's more in line with the city the comprehensive plan spells out. What I mean is a more walkable and bikeable city. The problem you have with Shoshone is you've got it overbuilt for capacity. I just called the Idaho Transportation Department today, and we're running at about 13,000 average daily travelers. So you've got a four-lane road with two lanes in each direction when you could easily get by with a two-lane road. So what you have is you've got cars jockeying for position that are impatient and aggressive drivers. You're not going to change that by just adding turn lanes. You're still going to have too few cars for as many lanes as you got. So you're going to maybe fix some of the problem, but you're not going to fix all the problem. So what I propose is what's called a road diet. A road diet is a technique in transportation planning whereby the number of travel lanes and or effective width of the road is reduced in order to achieve systemic improvements. So right about here, Shoshone Street goes to 60 feet wide. It stays 60 feet wide all the way down to Washington. Here you've got 6th Avenue as a bike lane. You've got no connectivity in your bike lane to Washington Street. So I'm saying that Shoshone could easily go to two lanes with a center turn lane, all 10-foot width. You could have 2 5-foot bike lanes, and then you could have a 10-foot parking lane on the side of the road that the park is on. You're going to, depending on how long you make your turnout, you might lose a couple of more spots, but you're basically going to have the same amount of effective parking with either solution. This solution is just going to yield a city, you know, you're going to have a city with traffic flowing just as fine. It's posted 25 miles an hour through there. Do you get people going 25? No. There's tons of police in here. They'll tell you that you can't enforce that because you've got a road that's designed to travel faster. So you're still going to have that faster. I just think that we need to be looking at more long-term solutions and maybe a little bigger planning. The Federal Highway Safety Administration, the Federal Highway Administration advises roadways with an ADT of 20,000 or less may be candidates for road diets. And there's a whole webpage on the Federal Highway Administration page that can fill you all in on them. But I think that it would be a much better solution to go to two lanes, center turn, all 10-foot. And 10-foot lanes there's numerous studies that have come out in the last number of years that 10-foot lanes are way safer than 12-foot lanes. Now, that sounds counterintuitive, but when you're driving a 10-foot lane, you're forced to pay attention a lot more than you are in a 12-foot lane. A 12-foot lane is a lot more forgiving, so you get people taking advantage of that. That's just my 2 cents on the subject. Thanks.
Thank you, Eric. Council direction. Chris Talkington.
Travis, is Shoshone controlled by ITD at all? I forget if that's a 30. Jackie, I guess I could ask you. Do we have complete control of that?
We don't. That is a Shoshone as a roadway is shared part of the ITD, as I understand it, right, Jackie?
That's accurate.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
The shared portion goes from the seconds in a generally southerly direction to the bridge and beyond.
Chris Talkington.
Well, just to continue with it, I appreciate Eric where he's coming from. He shared his book with me, and we are not a very walkable community. Given the difficulty of undertaking major reconstruction on Shoshone, I still think there's some merit of proceeding with the shortened 50-foot turn lanes on the described avenues, and we could make a longer on Shoshone Street, and can make, a long-term inquiry and study for maybe a better permanent solution of the 13,000 a day vehicles that are on Shoshone. Eric is right. When you have a lane that's 10 feet wide, people tend to slow down. When it's 12 feet wide, they tend to speed up and don't pay quite as much attention. I like the concept, but I'm not sure we're there yet. So I would support the make that a motion to support the striping, of the 50-foot left turns on the described areas.
Thanks. I'll second that.
So, motion by Chris Talkington, second by Greg Lanting, to support a preliminary design for the intersections of Shoshone Street at 4th Avenue East and 6th Avenue East with a 50-foot
storage
in the turn bay. Is there further discussion? I would add that I think that Mr. Smallwood's observations are valid, and I think that including that in the ongoing discussion of the master transportation planning to improve connectivity and safety and traffic flow and all those things, I do think is a good long-term strategy. I think with this particular project, we have the opportunity to give it a shot and see that it doesn't cause. I do think it will solve some challenges. But perhaps there are, you know, bigger fish to fry with the long-term planning down there. Is there any further discussion? Chair, roll call vote, please.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Sean Berger?
Yes.
Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Christopher Reed?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jackie. Next is a presentation on the progress of City Hall and Public Safety Campus projects. We have Jason Derricott with Star Corporation.
Thank you, members of the council. I appreciate the opportunity tonight to update you briefly on what you saw as we did the field site review today. I appreciate your time and your interest in coming out to seeing how the projects are progressing. We continue to be excited to be part of these projects and are proud of the work that's happening downtown. At the admin building, I just wanted to recap a few things that we talked about. We are wrapping up the landscaping there currently, and we do have some rework that will be happening the weekend before Memorial Day and the weekend of Memorial Day, mainly to replace some tile that has been rejected and that will be replaced. At the operations building, the demolition is wrapping up currently. You saw that the new windows have been cut into the walls. Those will be removed this week, and interior demolition will finish. Right as that finishes, the underslab plumbing will begin and framing will start right after that so that the electrical and plumbing and mechanical systems can be roughed in and prepared for gypsum board. So the project progresses well, and we're on schedule on both of those projects with the completion of early October for the operations building. At the City Hall project, we have multiple things happening on all floors. In the basement, the mechanical electrical plumbing rough-in is completing, and we're getting into the gypsum board stage where that'll start going on the walls. You saw some of that today on certain walls being hung. On the first floor, framing in a few select areas still continues as mechanical and electrical plumbing activities proceed. The second floor, the framing is about 80% wrapped up with a few small areas, walkways from stairwells to be finished, and mechanical electrical plumbing is about 40% there. On the third floor, we're just starting the framing stage there, and that will progress over the next couple of weeks, and then shortly after that, the rough-in of the mechanical electrical will start. On the exterior, you were able to see some of the sheathing starting to go on, the green board. That'll all be covered with tile later this spring, early summer. Windows will start to go in. We're just wrapping up the structural steel upgrades. Those will complete this week, and then all of that work will be finished, and they'll be out of the way. So things are progressing nicely there. We're still on track for a completion of early October. There will be some time associated with the city moving into those offices, but we'll turn it over for that process early October. So we're on schedule on that project as well. To address the question earlier about completion versus budget, We have billed 54% on the operations and admin or the public safety project and 26% on the city hall project. And just as a reminder, this is a guaranteed maximum price contract. So barring any additional scope, and scope being additional square footage or revisions to the finishes, added doors, that type of thing, you won't ever go over that price that's set for the current scope of work. So just wanted to update you on what's been billed and the percentages compared to what's been completed out there. I believe we're under billed on the city hall, but that's because 3 weeks have passed since we billed for the March work. So there'll always be a lapse in that calculation there. So any questions on what you saw today or progress on where we're going from here? That's good.
Greg Lanting.
Well, I'd just like to thank you for your tour today to start to get a little more of a vision. We saw it on the flat, you know, the drawings and things, and had an idea what was going to occur. But I still go back to the, you know, reason you hire an architect. They came up with ways to use spaces in that building that I could not come up with on my own, I'm sure. And so I really appreciate that stage of it, as well as the job you guys are doing on bringing this dream to fruition.
Thank you.
Looks like you're off the hook easy.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks for the presentation.
You left us speechless.
Next is a presentation of the Long-Term Planning Committee's budget recommendations. We have Doug Gonzalez, Kathy Marcus, Matt Barnes, and Nate Murray.
I'll get us started here. Thank you, Mayor and Council, for having us. So for those in the audience and also a new council member that might not be aware, long-term planning is kind of a unique process in which representatives from various city departments come together and make budget requests and recommendations by prioritizing needs against the city's strategic plan. The end result is then a five-year projection of operational expenses for the city. I'd like to just take a moment to introduce our team. I'll just read the names. There's about 20 people that spent quite a bit of time working on this. We were led by John Caton and Lori Race. We'll said Brent Wright, Terry Thewson, Scott Sagworth and Ronnie Curie from Fire, Tammy Lauda, Steve O'Connor, and Jonathan Spenlove from Planning, Shane Carpenter and Janie Higgins, Rob Bowling, Norm Hatke, Matt Barnes, Mark Thompson, Kathy Marcus, Lee Glazeman, Jared Brody, and Doug Gonzalez. So we're much appreciative of them, as well as the other members of the city that gave their time to give tours and also add additional insights to the things that we discussed. So it was an extremely engaging process. It is kind of its core, part of our one city principle that we espouse. And many of the items that have been discussed or have been discussed at length in our committee. And although we're focused on the highlights in this presentation, we can provide more detailed insight as needed if you have specific questions. That's why our whole team is here. So each year we're tasked with coming to as close as to putting forth a balanced budget as possible. And we believe this is the closest we've come as a committee to accomplishing that goal. Ultimately, the city management team will put forth a balanced budget, but hopefully this process has done a lot of the heavy lifting to get us to that point. So remember, these are recommendations, and this presentation we've tried to focus on items that we've deemed most important to reaching our overall goals as compared to the strategic plan. At times it's been difficult, even stressful a bit, participating in these matters that are important to each individual department. And some items that our group has deemed important have been advanced to later years in the budgeting process, and some of those items were advanced from previous years, and so at some point we'll need to address those. But our discussion tonight will follow the path of the 8 focus areas of the strategic plan, with 4 presenters taking 2 areas each. Doug Gonzalez will speak first on the budgetary expenses related to fulfilling our goal as a healthy community.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. I am the wastewater superintendent. This is only my second year in LTP, but my first time as a presenter. I've learned so much about the budgeting process in the last 2 years. Hearing all the needs of the department citywide has given me a much greater appreciation for what all of us do. The collaboration between departments and the willingness to share information and help with projects not only has a cost savings, but makes us stronger as an organizational team. Something we revived this year was taking tours of different locations so we could get a better understanding of projects being proposed. There was a great deal of value in doing this so we could see firsthand what issues were being brought forward to the LTP group. We looked at the floor on the band shell at the city park. And as you can see here, the floor is starting to show its age and beginning to sag. Due to the joists showing some water damage, as you can see. Replacing the floor with concrete is a better long-term solution, so this beautiful structure will be enjoyed by families for years to come. The construction of the floor will be $55,000. Also, the bathrooms were looked at, and also a large power panel that sits out in the open, making it susceptible to possible vandalism. With moving the panel and upgrading the power and putting it in the new bathroom structure with the cost of $205,000, not only cleans up the look of the park, but reduces the chances of power outages during events, making much more enjoyable experience for vendors and the community. Another stop on our tour was the municipal golf course. We looked at a storage shed and recommended that some money was put aside for instead of replacing this whole building, that engineering and cost analysis should be done for $20,000 to make best use of this existing structure. But they will need temporary storage, so an apex container is being asked to keep the equipment out of the elements. The bridges were also looked at by this group. The bridges are in need of replacement due to damage of the support timbers underneath. There is a significant amount of traffic from carts and maintenance vehicles. Money has been asked for in the past for the cost of these structures, and engineering made them more costly than expected. In exploring other options, they have come up with a number of $38,000 after exploring more cost-effective solutions, such as placing pipe culverts in place of concrete structures to bridge the gap to alleviate and alleviate engineering costs. One of my favorites was the Evel Knievel jump site. With the momentum of investment and community partnerships to connect the trail just to the west of this site makes this historic area more accessible to a larger number of people. Doing some site improvements for $12,000, such as stabilizing the road, updating the fences, and putting in parking area, not only makes us a good neighbor to the surrounding residents, but will make this sought-after destination much more enjoyable to visit. And also by recommendation, there was a recreation center looked at. The money that was approved last year to have a committee explore design, amenities, location, and funding is currently being addressed. Wendy is writing the charter for the committee and is planning to take it to council on the 24th of this month. Also, finding ways to improve roadways for emergency response is an ongoing endeavor. This last year, the street department implemented by the idea of one of their operators a more efficient way of plowing their over 200 lane miles of priority one routes and over 600 lane miles of total in the city. What a great example of using frontline people to improve our processes. Being more efficient in this process helps aid responses by getting roads passable more quickly for police, fire, and ambulance service. Keeping up with stormwater maintenance also aids in these issues. With the constant thaw and freeze of snow, especially this last year, helps in greatly reducing the hazards of standing water in the roadways. It was definitely a group effort this year, and with the purchase of a few new snow removal implements for existing equipment by water and parks, such as a plow and a harness, for $20,000 can help alleviate some of the pressures due to clearing parking lots and customer calls. We know that this last winter was rare, but it did show us a few areas we could better serve our customers.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. I am here to present Focus Area 2, which is Learning Community. The city will support the efforts of others in creating a well-educated and trained community to ensure maximum levels of success in our community. That's the goal of Focus Area number 2. So each year the city has the resolution, well, there's an existing resolution in place that stipulates funding for public art services each year. So the committee is recommending $5,092 to be dedicated to public art. This funding enables the city and city partners to create artistic areas such as the Five Point Project. These art projects enhance the beauty of our community. The city also supports the education of our community by participating in events such as the Magic Valley Adult and Student Leadership Programs. Through these programs, which are sponsored by the Chamber of Commerce, people in the community are able to learn about our city through the Law and Justice Day and Local Government Day. This is an excellent program which I've been able to participate in, and it gives you a chance to network with others and also learn a lot about your community, not only the government, but the small business, parks. It teaches you all kinds of wonderful things about our community, so it's good that we participate in that, in my opinion. We also have Youth Council, which provide the youth with an opportunity to learn about the government process and understand that they contribute to change and they can understand their responsibility in helping to shape our community. We have internships that several of our departments have each summer, which helps students learn on-the-job training for their future careers or what they're interested in. The Public Works Department has some. Engineering had an intern for a year. Travis had an intern last year, and this year I've already hired my intern, and you might see him out amongst the community. He's inventorying all of the light poles within the city, and so he's out there with the orange vest on, hitting all the light poles, GPSing them, and sticking stickers on them so that we can enter them later into CityWorks. We also have educational fairs, which help the citizens learn to ask questions and be able to participate in government. And we have community volunteers. One of the goals of the next year is to strengthen our partnerships in schools and hospitals. Our existing partnerships with the schools provides for school resource officers for each of our schools. And this year, the LTP is recommending funding for an FTP for South Hills Middle School. The funding for this position is split between the school district and between the city. So the cost to the city for this position is $29,076. By being at the schools, they're able to teach and interact with the students. One of the very successful programs that they have at the school is the Every 15 Minutes program. Every 15 minutes, someone dies from an alcohol-related collision. And this program challenges the youth to think about drinking, driving, and it challenges them to make responsible decisions. The City of Twin Falls funds programs such as the SRO program and the others that I've mentioned to ensure the maximum level of success possible in meeting the educational standards of our city citizens. And next we have Matt with Secure Community.
Good evening, Mayor and Council members. my name is Matt Barnes, and I'm part of the airport team. I'll be discussing Focus Area 3, Secure Community, and Focus Area 4, Accessible Community. LTP recommends that we add one half-time electrical inspector. This position is in response to a 29% increase in new single-family dwellings compared to last year. The building department expects this growth to continue into the future. The cost of this position is $25,306, including a $10,000 savings in overtime. all departments have vehicle replacement plans that we want to follow. At first, it looked like our group was going to significantly cut the number of vehicles and equipment out of next year's recommendation. After discussion and careful prioritization, LTP found that we could fit most of the requested needs back into our recommendation. Our recommendation does push 4 police vehicles and 1 new non-emergency vehicle for the fire department to outlying years. However, LTP is recommending many things, including 11 replacement police vehicles, a replacement fire chief command vehicle, and a replacement vehicle for the building department. We understand that prioritizing department needs is important, and LTP believes our recommendation meets most of our organization's needs. I would also say that as an organization, we should continue to be cautious and make sure we don't put ourselves back into a position of having outdated and or unreliable equipment. Police are incorporating new technologies. We support the police in increasing their maintenance and operations budget to accommodate body camera use and a replacement plan for electronic control weapons such as tasers. One of LTP's tours was of the police department's gun range. The police explained to the group their safety concerns because of the location. As you all know, the current rubber backstop requires periodic lead mining that is being addressed this current fiscal year. They also are limited on the type of training that they can do at the current facility. LTP recommends that police explore partnerships with law enforcement entities in the Magic Valley to create a new training facility to increase the quality, safety, and efficiency of officer firearms training. Information Services is currently testing new emergency radio equipment with the fire department. LTP recommends purchasing this new digital radio equipment next year. This equipment will keep us current and give our emergency services personnel increased communication capabilities like audio connectivity confirmation and user identification. If an officer were to call in for help, this technology would allow dispatch to see exactly who that officer is without the officer having to speak anything else into the radio. And radios could be programmed in-house by IS staff, along with many other benefits. A great example of the value of long-term planning is the collaboration across departments that took place. As a result of this collaboration, IS was able to identify a disaster recovery site for city-owned data that will require no additional capital investment. LTP recommends fire continue becoming better equipped to carry on meeting the overall goal of serving our community in the best way possible. We support purchasing equipment for firefighter safety, like additional breathing apparatus for the hazardous material team, and building improvements like a backup generator at Station 3. Fire is using the recently concluded fire safety delivery, the recently concluded fire service delivery and station location study to help determine how the fire department should grow into the future. I get to stay up here for 2 in a row instead of having to come back and forth. Next, we have focus area 4, accessible community. Vehicle replacement programs are also supported in this focus area for the street department to replace street sweepers, and engineering to replace a vehicle. Later this week, the council will have the opportunity to tour the recently completed terminal expansion project out at the airport. And LTP is recommending roof maintenance for the old section of the terminal building that wasn't eligible for this project. LTP is supporting 1 full-time street operator at a fully burdened cost of $79,610. The street department reviewed their processes and determined that eliminating their part-time seasonal salary budget in favor of a full-time operator that could be better trained and a more capable operator would achieve their goals. This strategy also partially funded the new full-time operator, so the actual new cost of this position is only $39,610. LTP is recommending continuing to fund maintenance of existing infrastructure to facilitate transportation for the public. Public works departments are using planning documents like the Transportation Master Plan to help direct projects. I enjoyed learning from Mark Thompson in the street department about how they plan to use the data from TransMap, another planning tool, to help them prioritize projects. They will be able to direct resources and effort in a way that will maximize dollars spent. There was another great discussion within long-term planning about the parks possibly collaborating with streets. These two departments talked about using streets zone maintenance strategy to help parks cut down the cost of maintaining pavement cared for by the Parks Department. LTP supports upgrading traffic signal controllers so that our signals are current with new technology. The Long-Term Planning Committee also recommends a traffic technician in the Engineering Department. This position is needed to ensure that our traffic signals are cared for and programmed appropriately to handle traffic patterns on our streets into the future. The cost of this position is $80,635, fully burdened. Next, Doug will come back up to speak to you guys about the environmental community. Thank you.
Air quality is always an ongoing process, especially in my line of work. There is currently a big job being completed on Canyon Springs Road with the installation of an odor scrubber in the dissipation box next to the road and adjacent to Canyon Springs Golf Course that should greatly reduce the unpleasant odors encountered by golfers and motorists. Another stop on our tour was the TSS, Total Suspended Solid Ponds, by the gun range. With the ponds at the gun range and at Auger Falls, we can reduce the amount of TSS, which is sediment, going into the river. In doing this process, we improve the quality of water going into the river, and the cleaning of the ponds and addition of new ponds is always ongoing. A piece of street equipment that creates a recyclable material is the zipper. With a cost of $180,000, that we pushed out till 2019, mills the road and greatly increases the size of jobs done in-house, but also produces a material that we can reuse with other projects within the city. The regrind produced makes a usable material for stabilizing roads and parking lots. With gravel being so expensive, we produce a material in-house that works just as well. The purchasing of equipment to make salt brine. By purchasing this equipment, we can accurately produce a de-icing agent that makes the best brine solution for the lowest melting temperatures. With a solution of 23.3%, it melts snow and ice at temperatures as low as minus 6 degrees. Also, with using more brine solution, it reduces the need for salt and sand mixtures, reducing cleanup, wear and tear on sweeping equipment, and the amount of material that ends up in the storm drains. The cost of the equipment is $30,000. And currently we have master plans in use for water, wastewater, and parks. We will add a stormwater master plan in 2019 for $300,000. Master plans are our playbook as our town and service areas grow. We can look at the impact of future development on our existing infrastructure, and as it ties in to our zone maintenance work as well. The pressurized irrigation master plan is being asked for again this next year for the cost of $250,000. We had the PI plan approved for this last fiscal year, but used the money to seize an opportunity to add a pump station north of Poleline on Grandview to help service Rock Creek Elementary School and Settlers Ridge and surrounding development. We as a city use approximately 8 million gallons a day in the off-irrigation season. The usage goes up to approximately 24,000 million gallons a day, with a good portion of the difference going to irrigation. Having a PI master plan helps us identify future opportunities and puts us in a position to take advantage of them and allows us to optimize the use of our most valuable natural resources, which is water, being a guide for us and the development community. Prime Point PI station will go on Falls and west of Grandview that will take West Haven and Rock Creek Estates off of potable water, savings of about 250,000 gallons per day, and service the new development being plotted just south of Falls and Grandview. South Hills PI station, which is on Harrison 3600, will take an existing subdivision using potable water and convert it to irrigation use, with a water savings of approximately 250,000 gallons per day. This will also aid in future development that is being proposed for north of 3600. With the continuing efforts by the Water Department, they also work on water conservation through education. It takes the efforts of all of us as consumers to help preserve our most valuable resource.
That's half of a major industry, half a million.
Yeah, exactly. So there are relatively few new operational expenses related to the Prosperous Community focus area, other than those addressed in the, I guess, related to cultural and recreational opportunities that we talked about in focus areas 1 and 2 for the arts and for the golf course. But this was an area we felt we could leverage a lot of our existing relationships in the region to reach a lot of common goals. Much of the revitalization of our downtown is being funded through the Urban Renewal Agency, which the city supports. Also, a lot of our marketing efforts for tourism and the airport are happening with the assistance of Southern Idaho Tourism, the Chamber, and CEDU. And the State Department of Commerce helps maintain an accurate database of available building sites in the Twin Falls area. We are recommending a new one-time expenditure of additional survey software for data collection and analysis to assist with our business retention and expansion efforts at a cost of approximately $1,500. We've made attempts in our economic development efforts to leverage talent through contracting specific services in this area rather than bring on new permanent staff.
So focus area 7 is responsible community. No capital funds are recommended to be allocated in this area. The activities that we'll be doing in this area are all from operational budgets. The community is actively engaged in Twin Falls, and we saw that at the recent council meeting when all of the people were here for the Senior Center volunteers. It was Volunteer Day, and then after that you had another volunteer group. And that's the goal, is to get the community involved in Twin Falls. So here we have a picture of a community fair. We hold community fairs in conjunction with downtown events. These give the citizens a casual way to interact with city employees. It also lets them ask questions and learn about what kind of community events they could participate in and what committees they can operate on. We have several community engagement programs in effect currently, the Downtown Commons, the Airport Advisory, the Archway Advisory, Building Inspection, and the list goes on and on. But I couldn't miss this opportunity to mention again the Archway Committee. And this is a very beneficial committee, as we talked about earlier. The citizens are very actively involved, and they're going to help raise the funds for this archway. We also have the education of the youth, and we continue to participate in national surveys. We want to educate our community and our new employees, and that picture didn't really do it justice, but this is the welcome packet that's available at City Hall. It includes information on recycling and a sustainable government, and it also tells you more parks and rec activity. And then on the back side, it has information about who you can contact in the city if you have different issues that you would like resolved, and some Bisbee photos, so it takes you from the old times to the current times. And if anyone wants to look at it, you're welcome to, or you can pick one up at City Hall. These welcome packets have been created just to engage our citizens, let them know that we care about them and that we want them to know the contact information is available for them so that they could let us know if they have problems or issues. And the community has worked with several partners to make sure that that we get our message out to the community. One of the things that the long-term planning committee is recommending is that we upgrade the website. And this is a free Civic Plus Aurora upgrade. So we'll be using the existing platform with our free upgrade to their new, our existing software with a free upgrade to their new platform, which is more mobile friendly. It has more options for users to search, and it'll make it a lot, the end product will be a lot more user friendly. And the best part about it, it's free, so it doesn't add to any of the expenses that we currently have, but it will meet the needs of our citizens. It'll provide them community information about events and make them feel welcome to participate in events and help everyone feel as they are part of our tightly knit community of Twin Falls.
So the last focus area is our internal organization, which is ourselves as employees. So Twin Falls is a growing community. We feel that we're reaching a critical point where if we want to maintain a consistent level of service provided to the residents, we need to invest in additional personnel as well as additional tools and technology, both of which carry significant costs. And we've tried to balance these against one another as a long-term planning committee. We've always proclaimed that our most important resource as an organization is our people. Sorry. We recommend to continue to fund and support initiatives such as One City, Magic Valley Chamber Leadership, and other similar training and career development programs for employees. We're excited about the new facilities that we've recently have recently completed, as well as those under construction. With these facilities comes a new opportunity, I guess, to look at the process that we function under and see if our duties are in line with the types of services we ought to be providing. This is more of a policy decision to be made by the City Council manager, but do we expand our workforce or prioritize our workload to meet the needs of a growing population? This was a question that drove much of the discussion in the long-term planning committee throughout the last couple months, and it was a recurring topic. We do recommend some new types of, new items such as time clock software, mail sorting and stuffing machines, GPS units that we believe will save employees time spent on less productive tasks. There's a fair amount of new information services equipment, including the radio systems and fiber and electrical equipment that we also think can save us time and money in the future with improved efficiencies as we implement these technologies. With this recommendation, the police department has asked to do a staffing study to identify the level of services, whether or not their level of services are in line with existing personnel, and that they'll look at things like shift deployment, call response, and other activities that are particular to the police force. And so there are 14 new positions that were initially made, positions initially made with this budget. The long-term planning committee voted and made decisions based on priority. We ended up with 3.5 new hires, half being the part-time electrical inspector. We have more specific information that you want to talk about. But this is our presentation for these 8 focus areas, and happy to answer any questions that you may have as a council of any of the individuals in the room.
Chris Reed.
I just want to say thank you for this. This is wonderful information, and thank you to those that presented. Really gave us a good view of what you guys have been working on. So, again, thank you for this.
So I have a question. So we received this in our packets, which is a big spreadsheet. So can you walk me through the detail on what exactly is everything that's in here part of the long-term planning for the next year, and what were the revised ones that came out later today? Maybe Lori can chime in on that.
So what they did with that, what we did with that spreadsheet, is it's just the capital items broken down by focus area.
One thing, we did include funding for table move and performance adjustments for the employees, plus included funding for changes to health insurance. And when we look at the M&O piece across the board, just for planning purposes, we increased our M&O by a historical amount, just so we would have some idea. Again, this isn't the scrutinized piece where you put it under the microscope and really nail it down. It's just meant to be a planning document.
Thank you.
You bet.
Let's see. Greg Lanting.
Lori, just to make sure I understand, these are the ones that made it through your committee is what we have here?
Right.
Do we have a list of things that didn't make it through your committee?
I think we can get that for you, Greg.
Okay, that'd be great.
You bet.
Travis, did you want to add something to that?
So I think it's important to remember and maybe kind of set the stage for this process as it kind of rolls forward with the entire budgeting process moving forward. I agree. We had the opportunity as the Executive Leadership Committee to listen to their presentation on Thursday, and I think that they all deserve to be applauded for the effort, the work that they put into this. The significance of this document is that over the course of the last several years that we've been doing this, this represents about 90% of the budget that we ultimately present before you. The Long-Term Planning Committee does their work, and really they do it with a lot of incomplete information. And as we continue to drive closer to the time in which we present a balanced budget for your consideration, more information becomes much more readily available, and so then we have a more complete picture of some of the things that we need to move forward with. The items that were presented this evening, as well as the positions, will then go into that next iteration, and department leaders will be submitting their budgets as part of their budgetary practice, and they will submit those, and then we will review that information and compare it to what was submitted as part of the long-term planning group. If the process has worked, the department leaders have been communicating throughout the entire process with their long-term planning representatives, and their project should be included in here. Again, sometimes there's incomplete information and there are new things that tend to emerge. What we will do is, at the executive leadership team, we will take this information and we will then compile the budget based upon how we're seeing, again, using this as that foundation moving forward. That budget will be presented to you in July, in which we will have a series of conversations from about the second week in July all the way through the public hearing, which will occur the first week in April. If there's any fee resolutions and where you'll adopt the tentative, or excuse me, August.
Yep. Oh, there you go.
Yeah, please.
I wish we had till April, right, a whole year to do this. And then at the end of August of every year, we'll ask for you to adopt the final budget with the public hearing associated with that process. So know that the information that is left off of the long-term planning was not included, and they have also taken projects, and they have built really a five-year possible funding opportunity for, I think, which would be probably more valuable for you to see as opposed to what wasn't included. The idea and the value of the long-term planning committee is we can really begin to identify those out years that have large capital demands and see if there's a way that we can spread those across other fiscal years where the demands might be a little lighter. And so it gives us the opportunity to kind of meet those needs and project moving forward. But again, this work here is invaluable to the entire budgeting process. This group has spent the last 4 months building, developing, having conversations about the budget, and they still had to do their day jobs. That workload doesn't stop, and so when they take on these additional tasks, I hope they get a lot out of that, but I know the organization certainly receives tremendous value in that presentation was tonight.
Thank you, Travis. Ruth Pierce.
So, Lori, what is table movement? I mean, it sounds pretty obvious, but I don't think it's what I think it is.
Okay. You know, sometimes when you work with this stuff all the time, you just assume everybody knows what you're talking about. So it's our salary table.
Okay.
And we budgeted a percentage to move that table.
Okay, excellent.
Then, yeah.
Perfect.
People within it.
Thank you.
Chris Talkington.
Yeah, I want to be sure I understand, Lori. If you'll go up there, then the right-hand yellow column are the final recommendations for this year's budget, but those items not included adjacent to the numbers are blank spaces, and the yellow would be not recommendations you're pursuing for this upcoming budget year.
So, Chris, I believe that the sheet that you have, it's obviously done by focus area, and those items listed, the projects listed, and the dollar amounts, and right. And that's the way the spreadsheet was originally prepared. But some of us in finance that are a little bit more have to have things sorted a certain way.
Well, let me deal with the specific. Under the Canyon Springs Hypochlorite Station, that was budgeted originally for $210,000. Now it's $1,000,001. That's gone up 5.5.
These are subtotals.
So the
that's a subtotal then.
Looks like the by account they're coming out of.
Area.
By department and then also by focus area. Yeah.
Right. Yes. So the reason that it's that those that column is highlighted in yellow is because the initial spreadsheet that we sent out didn't have that column, and we were told that anytime you have changes, you like to see them highlighted. So what you have, the first column is the fund, so that's what fund it's coming from. The second is the department or within parks, which park it is. The third column is the description of the items that we're recommending get purchased. The fourth column is the amount of the purchase, and then the yellow highlighted column has totals for each fund of how much we're recommending.
I think the reason it's a little confusing is because the streets on the top only has one item, so it's an exact same number. The rest of them have multiple items and then become the 153,000 all added together.
Right. Okay. And then when you get down to the very bottom where we're talking people, the salary is not just salary, it's the fully burdened cost. And then you have the savings from whatever the savings source was, and then the actual cost is the last column.
Gotcha.
Chris, I would just add that at the bottom of each focus area is the total of all those.
Right. Yeah, I'm missing some solid lines indicating totals.
Oh, sorry about that.
Any other comments from the council? Well, thank you all for your presentation, and as a great kickoff to budget season.
Yes.
Meeting one of
17.
15. Only 15. So.
You
seriously,
said this represents 80 or 90% of the total budgeting process, the work they've done?
Yeah, so typically in the past, their work has about 90% of their effort makes its way into the final budget that you ultimately see.
Very impressive. Way to go, guys.
Yeah.
Thank you for all of your work to everyone on the committee. So we appreciate it. Next on the agenda, we have a presentation of the Twin Falls Police Department's 2016 annual report and to discuss ongoing projects. Greg Lanting.
It's been almost 2 hours.
Mr. Mayor, this next presentation is an hour long.
Sure. We'll go ahead and take about a 5-minute break.
Thank you. I saw that hour.
The council meeting after our short break, and we'll turn the time over now to our police chief, Craig Kingsbury. Welcome, chief.
Thank you, Mayor and Council, and everybody in the audience this evening. Thanks for having us out here. We just wanted to take a little bit of time to talk about some of the things that happened in 2016 and then spend some time talking about some things that are going forward for your police department. January 1 of 2016, I'm sure many of you remember, I became the chief of police here for the Twin Falls Police Department. And I couldn't have been more happy with my choice to come here, and I still feel very honored that you folks chose me to lead this agency. This is a great agency within a great city, and as the long-term planning coalition that was presenting earlier summed up very nicely or stated, our people are one of our best resources that we have in the organization. So we have several presentations, and we're going to break those down. So tonight, I'm going to talk a little bit about our annual report, which you have in front of you, go over some of the things that have happened in 2016, And then I'm going to talk about a new partnership we have upcoming with the Twin Falls Sheriff's Office. And after that, Sergeant Solomon's going to talk about crisis intervention team. Sergeant Howe is going to talk about our new department phlebotomist. They may even offer to draw blood if you'd like them to do that for you. Sergeant Diamond's going to talk about our Citizens Academy and our Student Academy, which is upcoming here this summer. Staff Sergeant Wright will talk about body cameras. Sergeant Frick is going to talk about a program where police officers will be carrying Narcan, and he'll tell you a little bit about why we're carrying that and what that is going to help us with. And then finally, Lieutenant Thewison is going to wind us up, or wrap us up, if you will, talking about a new program that we've installed called IA Pro, and he'll explain that. So, first of all, I think everybody received a copy of our annual report. And I think that one of the most important things in our annual report is the mission statement right up at the top. The mission of Twin Falls Police Department is to provide excellent customer service, professional law enforcement, and effective crime prevention for a safe community. If you look over towards the lower left, you'll see our values, and we utilize the acronym in the police department of PRIDE. And so you can see that's professionalism, respect, integrity, dignity, and excellence. And I think those go really well when we talk about the values of the city of Twin Falls and one city, when we talk about teamwork and integrity and all those values that we have as a city within one city. Our police department, I was speaking earlier as we were touring the new building. As of today, we are authorized by council for 77 sworn police officer positions. We currently have on the payroll 77 sworn police officers, so that's an exciting time. We, as you know, last year, or last month, hired a victim witness coordinator that you met her a couple of weeks ago when she came up here to meet the council, Kimberly Burkholder. And she has been doing a wonderful job working within the department to really take us to the next level when it comes to service to victims of crime. We have 100 total employees at the Twin Falls Police Department. That includes our administrative services division. It also does include our dispatch center currently. And last year, dispatch came out from underneath the police department, and communications has now become its own department. And that is run by Tammy Lotta as the director of our communications section. We also currently have animal control, community service officers, and a couple executive assistants that work within the police department. Our policing services are divided into three sections, the criminal investigations division, the patrol division, and administrative services division. Patrol division are the men and women that you see day in and day out driving around in the black and whites. Criminal Investigations Division, those are the detectives, the men and women that work with our juvenile crime unit, school resource officers, things of that sort. And Administrative Service Division includes all of the police assistants that work out of records. It includes, it's overseen by Captain Barnhart, Lieutenant Thewison, Staff Sergeant Wright serving in Administrative Services Division. So we'll go to page two and look a little bit about our city and about the police department. You can see at the top on calls for service, TFPD handled 54,828 calls for service last year, and that's up a little over 4% from the previous year. And you can kind of see where that has seemed to have risen every year in the 4 years that are shown there in that box. Our arrests have stayed relatively the same over the last 3 years, whereas we show that we made over 2,200 arrests in 2016. If you go back to 2014, as you can see, we had 2,300 arrests that our department had made. Going forward over to page three, we talk a little bit about what are our top calls for service. This one, I think, sometimes seems to surprise members of the public, but I've been doing this for a long time. Animal calls. So when we talk about our 54,000 calls for service, that does include animal control type calls, and with over 3,000, almost 3,500 animal calls that our animal control officers handled, that can be anything from, I know one time they rescued a snake that they that Ed liked to bring through the station to make sure that I got to see it. They have rescued various birds and, of course, all the regular domestic animals, but animal calls and followed by traffic crashes or accidents. I think it's probably not a surprise to those of us that drive through, live in, or even sometimes visit the city of Twin Falls, is that we do have a few traffic crashes that occur primarily on some of our main thoroughfares, like Blue Lakes. But then we get involved in a lot of different other policing matters, and you can see how many we have classified by those different classifications there. And I know we have people that are viewing online, and what I would say is they can have access to this report on our webpage. We're going to put it on our webpage. We'll link to it through our Facebook page. So this annual report will be available for viewing by the community. I think we handed out copies to the members in the crowd. We do a lot of really neat things at TFPD, and one of my favorites is Coffee with a Cop. I know several of you have joined us as we've had Coffee with a Cop, and we've had some great partners within the community, some of the coffee shop owners that have helped us with that, sponsored that. And that's a great event for members of the community to come out and just talk to us. Sometimes they ask questions about crime or traffic, and sometimes they just sit down and have a cup of coffee, and we hand out stickers. And so it's really great for kind of breaking the ice and giving people that opportunity. One thing that I always think is interesting when you look at the amount of people, or not the amount of people, but where people come from that your officers interact with. And in 2016, about 30% of the people that were arrested by the Twin Falls Police Department do not reside in the city of Twin Falls. So I think that's something, as you're well aware, Council, we have a lot of people that come into our community. And so as a police department, we spend some time policing those that maybe you're visiting and not abiding by the rules as well. In fact, 46% of the people who received an infraction or misdemeanor citation did not reside in the city of Twin Falls. Now, going to the final page there, we're going to talk about some of these things moving forward later in this, so I'm not really going to talk about body worn cameras or IA Pro. I would just pause to ask Council if you have any questions, anything related to this report.
Chris Tarkenton.
Well, I think it's just worth reiterating to especially our viewing public that over your period of time, 2014 through 16, I guess, that, I've got to find it here. Felonies, I think, actually, where did I see that? Yeah, under arrest, excuse me, felonies actually decreased by almost 2.75%. How do you explain that, or what should we know about that?
You know, sometimes arrest, you know, explaining how the numbers, when you're trying to quantify arrests and you're quantifying with cases. So we took over, if you look at 2049 felony reports, some of those reports may have suspect information, some of them may not. Keeping in mind that a felony can be somebody breaking into an automobile in a neighborhood would constitute vehicle burglary, and therefore that would be classified as a felony report. Sometimes those types of cases are hard to solve because we may have a neighborhood that gets a couple that happen overnight, over a weekend, and there may not be much evidence for our officers to utilize. We try to solve those, but sometimes those do not get resolved with an arrest. A lot of our felony arrests, and I was just looking today at the first draft of our crime in Idaho, and you'll see that later. That'll come out in June. Well, I got the rough draft today. And when you look at a lot of our felony arrests, they are for what I would declare to be self-initiated activities by the police officers. In other words, they come across somebody who is possession of narcotics, and as we know, with the exception of marijuana, possession of any scheduled narcotic without a valid prescription is a felony. Again, narcotics an exception, and there are some other medicinal exceptions too, but so when we come across those people, that would lead to a felony arrest. A lot of our arrests are the result of self-initiated activity. But what you will see, and I'm very proud of, when we look at clearance rates, and that's how we actually clear an actual report that is filed, and it may not always be with an arrest. It may be with some sort of valid exception like prosecution declined. We're averaging a little over 44% in our clearance rate, and that's been consistent over the last few years. And I think that's a pretty good clearance rate. You know, a good batting average in baseball is 300, right? So we're hitting over 400, and we're always looking for ways to improve. But, Councilman Talkington, I don't have a great answer for why that is down a little bit compared to the year previous when you look at arrest. I would also say that we have had a lot of officers in training, field training. Therefore, we haven't had as many patrol officers out there on their own driving around and responding to calls or maybe getting into those self-initiated activities. You can see, though, that they've stayed pretty consistent, 530 felonies to 585 to 569 over the 3 years.
I just found it interesting, Chief, because with our town growing out of its own clothes, we're growing so quickly, and the inordinate amount of out-of-town people, as you addressed, a decrease in felony reports to my layman's sense just doesn't mesh. Thank you.
I understand that. Well, and so that gets to the next thing. Is there any more on about this? So moving on, if you remember, last fall, with your permission, we applied for a grant, a burn justice assistance grant or COPS grant to hire 4 police officers. And one of the reasons that we did that, and a little history, I mean, we're all aware of the homicide of Mr. Vason Whiteman that occurred a year ago May. So here we are almost a year ago from that event. As I think we're all aware, we have been able to charge 2 people with that crime, and that case is proceeding in the criminal court system. But one of the questions that I was asked by city leaders was to talk about or to explain to them what our quote-unquote gang problem. Do we have a gang problem in Twin Falls? And if you remember, we talked a lot about graffiti during that last year, and we even amended our graffiti ordinance in the city. And then it got to, well, what can we do as far as a police department and working with our partners to maybe increase our proactive policing abilities to focus on problem areas? So when Mr. Rothweiler approached me about maybe looking at a grant to hire more police officers, I went to Sheriff Carter and spoke with him, and he was all on board to talk about maybe taking some sheriff's deputies and combining them with some police officers and having a unit that has jurisdiction throughout Twin Falls County that can focus on some of these problem areas. So we are really in the infancy stages of that unit. We have hired the 4 police officers. We currently have 3 officers in training at CSI's law enforcement program, and we have another officer who is at the Post Academy in Marin, and he started there last week. So we have hired the officers for the grant. Those officers that were newly hired are not going to be the officers that become part of this team or this unit. But we are working with Sheriff Carter, working with the administration within the TFPD to get the mission statement and that grant up and running, or that program up and running. And we hope to have 4 investigators from Twin Falls Police Department, 2 investigators from the Sheriff's Office, and a sergeant and a staff sergeant from Twin Falls Police Department to lead the unit. And they will have countywide jurisdiction. And my idea is that they will be able to do things like document gang members. So that way, if we do get asked, if you get asked, we can tell you, you know, we have documented X number of gang members, and this is the type of gang issues or concerns we are seeing as a police department. Or maybe we can say, you know, we're just not seeing it, but we can actually have some data to provide. I want this unit to be involved in community education, working with our school resource officers, not just within the Twin Falls School District, but our neighbors. You know, this will be a countywide initiative. We also talked about the fact that 30% of our arrests are for people that do not reside in our city. When we look at the city of Twin Falls and some of these crimes, we do have people that come here to commit criminal activity from maybe our neighbors within Twin Falls County or maybe across the bridge or sometimes even farther. And this unit will have the ability to have jurisdiction anywhere in the county. So We have a great partner in Sheriff Carter, and I'm really excited. We will report more to you as time goes on, but we are really in the infancy stages of putting that together. Any questions on that? All right. I will now turn it over to Sergeant Solomon to talk about crisis intervention.
Thank you, Chief.
Good evening. In 1987, the Memphis Police Department dispatch received a 911 call from the family of a 27-year-old mentally ill young man. Police officers were dispatched to the home and were advised that the young man was armed with a large knife, had cut himself, was threatening family members as well as neighbors that were responding to the house to help. When officers arrived, there was a brief encounter, and the young man was shot and later died from his injuries. Through the investigation that followed, one of the main concerns was the officers' abilities to deal with the mentally ill. Major Sam Cochran with the Memphis Police Department stated, "Advocates have long asserted that law enforcement personnel often do not receive adequate mental health training, resulting in ineffective and sometimes fatal encounters and outcomes." In 1988, Major Sam Cochran partnered with local mental health colleagues to form the first crisis intervention team. The CIT model in Memphis saw amazing results. It resulted in a drop from the average 5 to 6 officer-involved shootings a year to 2. Mentally ill subjects reporting injuries dropped 40%, and officer injuries dropped 85%. And those are just to name a few. So what is CIT? CIT is a community-based partnership of mental health providers, law enforcement, and mental health consumers and their families. In order to be CIT certified, an officer must attend a 40-hour CIT academy. That academy is instructed by professionals from the medical and mental health field, as well as law enforcement personnel. The idea is to give our officers a base level of knowledge so that when they go out on the street, they can identify, not diagnose, identify mental illness and know the resources that are available to them to help deal with these situations. Officers are also trained in a 4-step de-escalation process that also focuses on tactics and safety for all of the involved parties. CIT of the Magic Valley held its first CIT Academy in 2010. Since then, they've held an academy every year with the exception of one. I became involved with CIT of the Magic Valley in 2015. In 2016, I received my CIT International certification as a regional coordinator for our area. Over the last 2 years, we have seen an immense interest in CIT from area agencies. Our last academy in November of 2016 had 26 participants that represented 7 area departments and agencies. 12 of those participants were from the Twin Falls Police Department. Our next academy is scheduled for November of 2017 here in Twin Falls. While it has not been publicized yet, I've already received several contacts from other agencies wanting to block numbers of seats in this upcoming academy. The Twin Falls Police Department currently has 19 certified CIT officers. 13 of those are active on patrol on the street. We also have 2 certified dispatchers. It is our goal that every officer in the Twin Falls Police Department and every dispatcher be CIT certified as we are able to do so. Our aim would be to have CIT certified officers and personnel around the clock available for our community to help serve when they reach these times of need and crisis. It is also my desire with the Twin Falls Police Department to develop an advanced CIT team. This team would consist of 1 or 2 officers per squad that are passionate and dedicated to this endeavor. These officers would receive regular advanced training to maintain and increase their skills. They would also serve in a monitoring role to help us keep track of these mental health calls. As this team develops, I really want to see us reach out to our community and inform them of this vital endeavor within our department. When a community has a need for these services, they should be able to call the department and request a CIT-trained officer to come assist them. With this partnership with our community in place, we can make the best effort possible to put the right people at the right place at the right time. As far as statistics, we are currently working for a better way to maintain our statistics for mental health calls. If I were to give you those statistics right now, they wouldn't be accurate. The reason for that is very few of the calls we go on that result in an encounter with a mentally ill subject are put in as a mental health call. Most of them will typically come in initially as a disturbance, a suspicious person, a fight, any other type of call. As a result, you can imagine that officers go out to these calls not knowing if they're going to encounter a mentally ill subject or not, and the reason that we want to see our officers trained in this CIT tactic. I am very excited to see CIT grow within our department. I've already seen the positive results. Officers have come up to me that may have been skeptical in the first place, but they are very appreciative of the skills that they have received. I am seeing officers now willing to look beyond the behavior they're seeing in front of them to the reason for that behavior, rather than reacting to just what they are seeing. One quick example, recently our officers were dispatched to the home of a young woman suffering from schizophrenia. She had barricaded herself in a bathroom. Family members had called us concerned for her safety, and that was a well-founded fear. The officer that arrived on scene was a fairly new officer. He hadn't had the opportunity to go through CIT Academy yet, and he called me requesting if I could come to help him. Unfortunately, at that time, I was on another emergency call and could not respond. However, I had an officer who had just attended a CIT Academy, and he was CIT certified, and I called him to respond. This officer responded, and within a short amount of time, he had made contact with this female and convinced her to come out of the bathroom on her own. That incident was resolved without injury, without use of force, and without arrest. And that is what CIT is about. Any questions?
Any questions? Don't see any. Thank you, Sergeant. That was a great presentation.
Yes, it is.
Are you going to ask for a volunteer to start, Sergeant Hale?
I was actually going to bring some tools and see if anybody wanted to volunteer. We could take care of everybody at the same time. We can make that happen. Do you not like blood? I'm Sergeant Howe. My name is not Gene, and I will not not pretend to be Gene today. So. I would like to talk to you a little bit about law enforcement phlebotomy. It's kind of up there, so I guess the cat's out of the bag. One of the things, and like the chief said, our crime statistics and our accident statistics are a year behind. So the 2015 numbers that I have, in Idaho, there were 30 murders in 2015. Traffic collisions in which at least one individual was intoxicated, either with drugs or alcohol, there were 87 fatalities. So over double the number of people in Idaho died because of impaired driving, as did because of murders. So slightly more than 40% of the collisions where fatalities occurred were DUI related. One of the things that the police department looked at doing, and with the direction of Chief Kingsbury, we started to look at the law enforcement phlebotomy program. And the law enforcement phlebotomy program began in Arizona in 1995. There were a couple of officers that began taking blood from individuals that were impaired and using that as evidence in court. And they found that that was wasn't necessarily a deterrent, but they found that they were getting better evidence. In 2009, Idaho became the second state with a statewide program for law enforcement phlebotomy. We weren't the second with phlebotomists, as Utah took a couple of the Arizona officers, but we don't count that. So 2009, some of the officers from the Nampa Police Department attended the first law enforcement phlebotomy program that occurred in Idaho. And this was taught by the College of Western Idaho. This past 3 weeks ago, actually, is when it started. Four officers from the Twin Falls Police Department attended the College of Western Idaho's law enforcement phlebotomy class. The officers that attended, I was actually one of the officers that was able to attend, and I will tell you that each of the officers that attended took my blood at least once, possibly several times each. As the class began, we all had to do approximately 48 hours of online learning. And then we went to the class, and we did another approximately 27 hours of in-class time, which included 25 successful blood draws on each other. So my arms were bruised, my hands were bruised. We all really enjoyed our time together. And then after that, we all had to complete a 40-hour clinical with at least 100 successful draws in our clinical settings. One of the officers actually just finished this morning. He finished his time up and completed his over 100 draws. There were a couple of us that got well over the 100. I believe it. My last count was approximately 200 draws. So if you want me to take your blood, I'm probably the most experienced. So I'd just like to throw that out. So the class was actually paid for through the Office of Highway Safety. They paid for the officers to attend. The only thing they didn't pay for is wages. They paid for meals. They paid for lodging. They even paid to send us a phlebotomy chair, which has not yet arrived. All in all, it's approximately a $5,000 price tag for the officers that attended. And this was donated to us. Training Sergeant Chris Glenn and the Idaho Traffic Safety Prosecutor, Jared Olson, coordinated this class and actually helped design the class so that it works for law enforcement. So what are the benefits? I mean, right now we have a great relationship with St. Luke's. They do our blood draws for us. What are the benefits that we get for having law enforcement phlebotomists? One of the issues that comes up sometimes is that the hospital is a clinical setting and they take blood for different purposes. For us, it's for an evidentiary purpose, and so we have to be able to treat that blood and take that blood with evidence in mind. The other thing that happens is sometimes the hospital is busy, and sometimes the staffing that they have there does not allow for them to make it to our requests in a timely manner. What the law enforcement phlebotomists are able to do is take the blood in a more timely manner. We also use less resources because we don't have to transport them to and from the hospital. Our program right now is still in its infancy, and we have not got everything in place. There are some things that we need to work out with the city legal counsel, and there are some things that we need to work out with the jail. Sheriff Carter is on board. I've spoken with him. I've spoken with the jail staff, and they're attempting to locate a place that we can make sure that we meet the needs of the city, the county, and then the individuals that may be arrested for driving under the influence. This is just another tool, along with the DUI court, along with the drug recognition experts that the department has, the other classes that we have in reducing drunk driving. It's in addition to the things that the community have done. The bars have paid for reduced rates. The taxi cab companies have reduced rates for people that, in order to keep that drunk driving down. So this is, again, another thing that we are doing as our part in the community to help reduce the drunk driving. Some of the people that I've talked to are concerned about officers on the roadside drawing blood. That's not what this program is designed to do. This program is designed to make sure that we keep the individuals safe that we're drawing blood. What it does is it just reduces the amount of time that we take in processing some of the evidence. We would never want to allow a murder to go because we didn't gather proper evidence. Why would we allow a drunk driving death or a drunk driving incident to go without gathering proper evidence? And the taking of the blood, again, within the confines of the law, makes sure that we do that properly. Are there any questions? I will be waiting around outside if you guys want to take your blood later. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sergeant.
Good evening, Mayor, members of council. I appreciate the opportunity to come here tonight and talk about something I'm quite passionate about. As the slide says, I'm Sergeant Diamond. I'm in charge of a few different things at the department, but my primary responsibility is I'm in charge of the Juvenile Crimes Unit, specifically with the Student Resource Officers. So you see the Students Academy, the Citizens Academy picture up there. That's something I'm involved with as well, and I'm pretty passionate about. In April of 2016, the department was kind enough to send me to some training down in Utah, where I was able to become certified to be a coordinator for a Citizens Police Academy. And our Citizens Police Academy, I tried to get the word out as best I could. I'm sure you saw the chief and I on Facebook a few times pitching the Citizens Academy. That is our graduation photo right there, and we were down about five people that couldn't make it that night, so it was a very successful program. We ran it from September of 2016 through November of 2016, and we had great participants. It ran for 12 weeks, got over right around Thanksgiving, and that's something we plan on doing again this year. We're also as a spinoff to the Citizens Academy, we're starting a volunteer program at the police department, and our first volunteers are going to come from that class right there. That's something that we're going to be doing here shortly. I've been in contact with them. We're kind of getting that stood up. They're going to help in the records division and a little bit in the detectives division to start with, and then we'll see how it goes from there. Working with the JCU, one of my jobs that I do is I work with the school district. I kind of act as a liaison between the police department and the school district. When I took that position over last year, I became aware of something that I'm sure a lot of people in here are, that seniors in high school have to do a senior project. And they're required to get 40 hours of more or less job training or education in that project before they can present that at their high school. The police department has always tried to assist them in that endeavor by offering our officers as mentors and also allowing them to come to the police department and do ride-alongs to try and get that 40 hours. I went to some of the counselors at the high school and talked to them about the program and what we could do as a police department to kind of improve the program. And what they told me was, first of all, the students a lot of times struggle to get their 40 hours. And the police department, we've tried to be as accommodating as we can, but quite often that 40 hours is taken up by ride-along time with our patrol division. So what we decided to do is we decided to take kind of the concept for the Citizens Academy and apply that to the students that need their hours, and also some other students that we're going to use to kind of fill some empty seats that we have, students that are interested in law enforcement. So to do that, we've modeled that, like I say, after the Citizens Academy model, and we have some of the goals. I sat down with the student resource officers as well as some of the counselors, and we kind of laid out some of the goals that we have for our student academy. And our student academy, first of all, like I said, we're modeling it after the Citizens Academy. We want to give interested high school students their 40 hours for their senior projects. We want to give them the opportunity to learn about law enforcement. We want to create a positive relationship between our youth and our local law enforcement. We want to develop a mutual understanding of the challenges that both our youth face and law enforcement faces. And then we want to teach and inform the students considering a law enforcement career and help them practice the skills that will be necessary for that career. So as we were kind of planning this, we've decided to partner with a couple other people. We've partnered with the College of Southern Idaho. They are going to allow us to use their facilities, and they're going to offer any help with instructors or anything like that we might need. We're also partnering with the Twin Falls County Sheriff's Department. So as we move forward with the academy, which will actually take place in the month of July, we have students from the Twin Falls School District, the Kimberly School District, the Filer School District, the Murtaugh School District, and the Castle Ford School District that will be attending. So we plan on having between 25 to 35 students in the academy. We're going to use the student resource officers, both from Twin Falls City and Twin Falls County, to run the academy. And Rob Storm from the College of Southern Idaho is also going to be involved with the program for those that are interested in a career in law enforcement. So some of the topics we're going to teach are similar to the Citizens Academy. They're going to get a history of law enforcement, drug recognition, the canine unit is going to spend a day with them, the bomb squad, the joint SWAT team between Twin Falls City and Twin Falls County. They're going to learn arrest techniques and how to use the taser. They're going to do some officer survival stuff, and then they're also going to do some emergency vehicle operation. So that's all I have. Do you have any questions?
Chris Toggington.
I'm assuming, Sergeant, you work with the probation staff out at the Snake River.
We do.
Too.
We do.
Oh, good. That's multi-county. I was out there about 13 years in juvenile adjudication. I'm very impressed, but it always seemed like there was kind of a lack of this coordination that you're providing within the county and the city. So kudos to you, and it's really needed. So
thank you.
Keep up the good work.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sergeant.
Mr. Mayor, members of council, thank you for giving us this opportunity to present some information to you guys tonight. Tonight, I'm just going to talk a little bit about our body camera update. By the way, I'm Staff Sergeant Wright, currently assigned to the Administrative Services Division within the Police Department. So at your directive, we proceeded forward with our body cam initiative. We started some infield testing in March of 2016. And initially, we were looking at a camera system that mounted up on the glasses or closer to the eye level of the officers. Those were actually a two-piece unit. And while we were infield testing with that, we quickly discovered that there were a lot of concerns and issues that we hadn't originally thought of with that two-piece unit. Primarily, the cord was very flimsy and were breaking a lot. So we reached out to some other departments that had deployed those originally, found out that they were having the same concerns that we were looking at. So we actually made a switch and decided to go with the one-piece unit like Officer O'Donnell's wearing right there. So after procuring that particular device, we started our training, and we recognized that we were trying to get the software with the back end software with evidence.com, which is the storage solution that we opted to go with, unlimited data storage, to get that to talk to our records system, to talk to our electronic citation system. We knew that there was going to be a lot of work that was going to have to happen kind of as we deployed. So we started out, deployed 12 cameras in September of 2016 to Sergeant Loosley's squad. We worked through some of those issues. We're still working through some of those issues. We think we've almost got them all solved. But in January of 2017, we felt pretty comfortable about rolling out some more cameras. So we actually trained Sergeant Coronado's squad along with a couple of JCU officers that totaled 14 people. We actually did our third iteration April 10th with Sergeant Hendrickson's squad. And tomorrow will be our final rollout for all of our sworn personnel. Now, there will be a makeup session because obviously there are scheduling issues all the time. Sergeant Howe, did he run out already? Yeah, he did. So he happened with his phlebotomy training. Unfortunately, he couldn't attend any of the training dates. So we've got a couple of officers that we're going to have to do a final training date. And after tomorrow, I will have a final count and know exactly who else needs to attend the training. But ultimately, tomorrow we will have almost everybody in the department trained and up and utilizing the program. Where did you write arrow? Oh, you're going to do it for me. All right, thank you. So I mentioned that we went with the we decided early on that we needed an unlimited data storage solution. And if you'll look, I pulled this off this morning. Right now, we are currently running 3.54 terabytes of data. 3.52 of that is video. We've also uploaded 475 megabyte of audio and 11.59 gigabyte of other things, which is primarily photographs. So the graph down at the bottom, you can kind of see our last 30 days. In the last 30 days, we were below 3 terabytes, and it has just been a steady increase as we've added cameras. And again, remember, the first rollout was only 12 people. We've only been running with 26 people for the last 3 months. So that number is about to go up exponentially when we finally get everybody up to speed. So how much data is that? I don't know if everybody knows what a terabyte is, but a terabyte is a trillion bytes. That hard drive was first introduced by Hitachi back in 2007. To kind of put in a little bit of perspective, if you were to record audio quality on a CD, it's over 2,000 hours of audio quality music to listen to. What does that mean for us? A lot of it is we don't have to burn as many discs as we had to in the past. So, a terabyte, again, we're at 3.5 terabyte, but 1 terabyte is 1,428 CD-ROMs, 212 DVDs, or 40 Blu-ray discs. So it's a lot of data. Don't hit play just yet. So obviously the next question is, what are we seeing out of this? How has it helped? It's going to be a few years probably before we actually have the manpower and the ability to actually look and see exactly where our uses of force go, where our citizen complaints go. But I did bring a couple of videos to show you, to share with you. So this is an example of, we had some officers that were standing outside, I think they're calling it the Brick House now. I've been off patrol for a little while. I think it's the Brick House now. We've had kind of a long-standing problem with fights out there. There's actually a couple other bars in the immediate vicinity. And Officer Asmir Karach was standing outside just watching people mill around. And this is what he captured without even intending to. So, JP, if you can kind of point. See the guy in the white T-shirt? No, that's over here. On the far right-hand side of the screen. JP, right.
Up straight up there.
Right at the base of the stairs. Now you see the guy coming down the stairs?
Yeah.
So the guy in the gray shirt coming down the stairs, they're just standing there watching, waiting to see if anything's going to happen. And this guy's going to walk up and punch the guy in the white shirt. And there you go. So obviously the officers were standing there, walked up, and were able to quickly contact both parties now and get them separated.
Come here. Escalate. Second time, bro. Second time in one night.
You notice the audio came on at that point, and that's because all of our cameras have a 30-second pre-record buffer. So Officer O'Donnell, I don't know if his main power switch is on right now, but if it is, he's recording you right now. It records all the time, and it basically just records on a 30-second loop. Should you find something noteworthy that you want to capture permanently, when he activates the camera, it actually picks up that 30 seconds. So that's what happened right there. So as soon as that guy walked down the steps and punched the other gentleman, the officer activated his camera and it captured the previous 30 seconds, which is pretty cool.
Minus the audio.
Minus the audio. So this next video, and Officer O'Donnell and I worked on redacting this today, so hopefully we got it all good. I blame him if it's bad. I've actually got two, I think they're about 20-second clips, so we're going to go ahead and run the first clip, and just then we'll talk about it.
Do you understand that, Stephen?
No, I don't.
Okay.
I don't have to go.
Okay, you do.
Turn around. Put your hands behind your back.
Nope.
Hey! Steven! Dispatch 358. He's fighting us. Can we get one more?
So, a couple things about that video, and then we'll show you the next video. Number one, as you can see, once, and I didn't make you listen to the 20 minutes before that where they tried to convince this person that he needed to go to jail. They were trying. But once the melee started, there wasn't a whole lot to see. You know, once the officer went in and made contact with him when he tried to run away, there's not a whole lot to see. And I want everybody, especially the community, to keep that in mind. Body cameras are great. They're a great tool. But they're not the end all. They're kind of like tasers. They're not 100% perfect. They don't work all the time. And they certainly don't capture everything. They're just one more piece of evidence to look at in the whole totality of the situation. So when we watch this second video, you're actually going to see that this young man actually punched the original officer and then tried to punch the second officer.
Put your hands behind your back.
No.
Now, With both of those angles, from a police department perspective, a couple things that we can take away from that. Number one, both of our officers got punched. Both of them responded appropriately, took the young man to the ground, secured him. Nobody got hurt. I don't know if you heard Officer Camo in the first video when she called for a second unit. Nice and calm, not upset, not bothered. Get him in handcuffs, get him taken care of. So that's a good thing. It is highlighting the good work that we know our people are doing every day. But again, that first video, if that was the only thing we had, you kind of might wonder, why did they tackle the person? Well, when you see the second video and you see that they're swinging haymakers from left field, that explains why we took him to the ground. So this last video, just a real short, quick clip, is a red light violation. As you can see, this is Sergeant Coronado sitting in his patrol car. These cameras, when they're mounted where Officer O'Donnell has his, they don't capture great from inside the car. That's not why we bought them, and we recognize that. But they still do capture some things. If you look up at the left turn light right in front of Sergeant Coronado, you'll see his light's green. And when we play this video, his light's green. Well, now it's red. Now it's green. And here comes a fully loaded milk truck through a red light.
Oops.
So they are capturing some things that we anticipated that they would. Hopefully, and answer some questions on our update. I'd be happy to answer any other questions. Okay, thank you.
Well, I guess a logical question is, it's admissible in court, too.
Yes, absolutely.
Even though you have multiple shots, you present the whole package or the one that shows the infraction, like the slugging the officers?
We are required by law to submit all of that evidence, even if it doesn't necessarily help our case. So it all goes forward.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Sergeant Frick. I'm here today to talk to you about Narcan. This is a medication that we're attempting to issue to our officers. Narcan is to help us with some of the most dangerous drugs as police officers we've ever dealt with. The two things that are most dangerous to us right now are two drugs, heroin and fentanyl. The reason that fentanyl especially is so dangerous to us is because it is very easy to get an accidental overdose. These overdoses, it's a transdermal drug, which means it goes through the skin. It also means if you're searching someone, you get your hands in their pockets, and they have one of these patches, if you're not wearing gloves, you can receive a dose of this without any intention of getting it. One of the other concerns is that fentanyl, in general, is 75 to 100 times more potent than your most potent drugs. In this case, 75 to 100% more potent than morphine, and approximately 30 to 50 times more potent than heroin itself. What we're seeing now is heroin that is laced with fentanyl, or the fentanyl becomes the transport agent for the heroin. So it's extremely dangerous. I'm going to have Officer O'Donnell play a video for you real quick showing two officers that had an exposure to this.
I'm Jack Riley, Deputy Administrator of the Drug Enforcement Administration. And I want to take a minute today
or a little longer
to talk to you about something very important. As a matter of fact, it could kill you. And that's fentanyl. Fentanyl now is being sold as heroin in virtually every corner of our country. It's produced clandestinely in Mexico and comes directly from China. It is 40 to 50 times stronger than street level heroin. A very small amount ingested or absorbed through your skin can kill you. Many times people that purchase this on the street or sell it on the street have no idea it's fentanyl and just how deadly a minute amount can be. But don't just listen to me. Listen to these two hard-working cops in which fentanyl almost got the best of.
In the process of sealing the bag, just out of force of habit, I grabbed the bag and I closed it up. forcing the air out of it so I get a good seal. And when I did that, a bunch of it poofed up into the air, right into our face, and we ended up inhaling it.
I felt like my body was shutting down. And I, the people around me said that I looked really white, I lost color. And it just really felt like that was it. I thought I was dying. That's what my body felt like. Like if I could imagine or describe a feeling where your body's completely shutting down and you know, preparing to stop.
Stop living, is what he says.
Living, you know, that's where, that's the feeling I felt.
You actually felt like you were dying. You couldn't breathe. Very disoriented. And everything you did was exaggerated in your mind, I guess. It was the most bizarre feeling that I never, ever would want to feel again, to be honest with you. And it was just a little bit. It was just a little bit of powder just puffed up in the air. It wasn't.
You get the idea. They go on a little bit more, and in essence, talking about what it felt like at the time. Naloxone is the actual name of the medicine. However, the trade name is Narcan. It's a medication that reverses the effects of heroin and opioid overdoses, and they call it the opioid antidote. It works by blocking the effects of heroin and opiates on the brain and reverses overdoses. What we're looking at purchasing is a aerosol deliverance system, which essentially is every officer would have the ability to have two of these on them. It is simple. You put it together, you put it in the nose, and you press the depressor. That's it. Once you push the plunger, the effects are very quick. One of the great things about this is, and we can't say no, right, because doctors are the ones who come up with this stuff. So when I say there is no known allergic reactions to this, they won't say that. They'll never say no known. So they'll say the likelihood of an allergic reaction is minimal. The potential side effects is when people come to, they go from lethargic, essentially about to die, to agitated and projectile vomit, almost inevitably. But it does save lives. Officers are carrying them in many agencies for the public that they come across that are ODing, as well as the potential for themselves. The last thing that was on this video that was mentioned was also the danger to canines. The danger to canines is identical to our own. So our canines right now are also carrying these in case they come across the same effects. According to the coroner's office, since 2015, the county of Twin Falls has had 29 various overdose deaths. These include opiates as well as other things. They might be an opiate and meth. They might be an opiate and alcohol. Might be misuse of prescription drugs. But that's the numbers that they were allowed to give us. The other positive on this end is because we have no real concerns regarding allergies, there's also no concern regarding a misdiagnosis. If I go up and you have nothing wrong with you and I spray this stuff in your nose, you're going to be annoyed that I sprayed something in your nose, but it's not going to have any other adverse effect to you. Has no effect whatsoever. The idea is that what's in this drug actually goes into your bloodstream and attaches itself to the opiates in your bloodstream and renders them inoperable and in essence saves your life. We see this as a real need, considering the world we live in, as a safety concern for our officers. And that's why we're trying to get it. Questions? I'm not a doctor. Didn't stay at Holiday Inn.
Nikki Boyd.
So an opiate is a type of a drug.
Yes.
And there's more than one kind.
Yes. I had hoped to be able to bring the doctor with us. Dr. Crail is the one who has overseen our program, so we have a doctor sign off on this.
Okay.
I would normally refer those questions to him, but since he's not here, I can at least tell you that.
Well, this topic actually came up at the dinner table the other day at the in-laws, and I wasn't exactly sure, you know, what was what, and so that's what I'm just asking. Why I'm asking, this fentanyl is one of the opiates.
Yes.
Okay, and that's the main one that we're seeing because they cut it in with the heroin?
It's not the main one, but it's the most concerning because of the delivery system with it.
Okay.
You know, heroin in general is dangerous. But again, when we're talking fentanyl and how much more potent that is, it takes a lot less. I was unfortunate enough to witness an OD and a man die because he had stolen some fentanyl patches and was chewing them, and it killed him. Nothing we could do at that time. That was several years ago. But that's the concern.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm.
Suzanne Hawkins?
What is the cost of the Narcan?
So a normal dosage from any of our pharmacies runs about $145 for two doses. Okay. In researching this, I was able to make contact with a company that has a first responder price, and they give us the same two doses, identical to what they would give to the pharmacy for $75 each. So not quite half, but a huge savings mm-hmm. for us. And one of the reasons we're going to be able to allow more officers to have access to it.
So what is the shelf life? If you get it today, is it gone in 6 months, a year? Or?
Excellent question. Normal shelf life, they list, is 2 years. However, when I talked to this company, they would only give us 18 months. And when I told them in ordering that I wanted the most current stuff for us so that it would have the longest shelf life.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you for the presentation.
Mayor and members of council, I was sitting there thinking this might be the first time in my life I could ever be accused of being a light at the end of the tunnel. But here I am.
I hope that means you brought videos too.
You know, I was accused that mine aren't as exciting, but I disagree with that. I have certainly some visual aids that I'm going to use, and they're in color. That's right. Chief Kingsbury asked me to introduce our latest professional standard software that we just implemented this past February in its first phase. We will introduce the second phase this coming May into our organization. IA Pro is professional standard software that is going to help us organizationally in a number of capacities. About a year ago, Chief Kingsbury stood up an Office of Professional Standards in our organization, and one of our primary goals was to look at our process and how we investigate, review, and track complaints, as well as internal investigations, traffic accidents, pursuits, and use of force within our organization. And as we reviewed that process, we found opportunity for us to improve in our proficiency and consistency in the way that we manage our complaints, our documentation, and the investigative process overall. IA Pro and Blue Team will help us improve this process and also gives us the opportunity or a more user-friendly ability to monitor our police integrity through a broad range of identification and intervention techniques. So when we pull up the software, I immediately, as the professional standards manager, have the ability to look at our organization overall, and I can see that right now we have, and this is as of January 2017, we have 6 use of force investigations, 2 Office of Professional Standards investigations, 2 vehicle crashes, 2 divisional investigations, and 3 vehicle pursuits that are outstanding, that are under investigation as we speak. And if I go into the system at some quick views, I can see exactly what we have organizationally for our investigations that are occurring right now. So this is basically the electronic file cabinet for all of our internal investigations, whether it be a citizen complaint, an internally generated complaint, a use of force, a vehicle crash, a pursuit. what have you, what any type of internal investigation that we are going to conduct or track and document can be housed right here in this filing cabinet, and it gives us the ability to immediately go into a file instead of having to go down to an office or a storage room and search through filing cabinets. It's right here available to us at the click of a button. We can also look immediately for employees if we want to know what an individual employee has been involved with. We can type in their name and it will pull up every internal investigation and the type of investigation that that employee has been involved with. It will tell us if that employee was a witness officer or the subject of that investigation, the subject of that complaint, or whatever that type of investigation was. One of the other things that I'm really excited and organizationally we're excited about is IAPRO gives us immediate access to an early intervention or warning system with our officers. It's very user-friendly in terms of setting up the trigger points as well as the threshold for different events or activities with our officers that would cause an alert to come forward. And even within just a couple of months, we already have an alert coming forward. And this just an alert is just something that goes out to the supervisor immediately, as soon as information and data is entered that triggers or meets the threshold of our trigger points, it sends that supervisor an alert saying, hey, this officer has been involved with A, B, and C, and it gives that supervisor a chance to review those components to determine if there is intervention that needs to take place or at least to document the reasons why that alert or those triggers have occurred, and gives us the ability to track what's taking place with our officers as they go through this alert and tracking process. In time, this system is also going to give us the ability to track our progress as an agency in any given or for any given time period. If we want to go into the charts, we can go in and we can look since January of 2017 to date for our use of force incidents. We have had 6 filed in February. We had 4 use of force investigations filed in March, and we had 5 use of force investigations filed in January. We can further break that down to get a better idea of what's going on. We can look at status. We have 7 use of force investigations that have been completely investigated and have been forwarded to our use of force board and our administrative staff for review and disposition. We have 3 investigations that are still actively being investigated, and we have 3 investigations that have been completed with dispositions. We can further break the information down by looking at divisions. We can see that 9 of our use of force investigations have come from our operations division, which includes patrol and investigations. I think we've got an error in entry here with 3 of them coming from police. That would be our administrative services division and our professional standards. And I know that I have not been involved in a use of force. And so I think we have some error in entry still that we're working our way through. But it gives us a really easy and quick view of exactly where we're at organizationally. And so we can chart those things and we can give that information that is representative of whatever time period we want to incorporate into our study. Ultimately, our goal is to deploy a highly skilled and professional organization that is responsive and transparent to our community. And I think, as you can see, IAPRO and Blue Team are definitely going to move us in that direction. giving our supervisors immediate access to what's going on with each individual officer that's assigned to their team. Are there any questions that I can answer?
I do have a question. So is there only data included in there since the time you've launched this, or are you going to go back in time to...
So that's one of the things that we looked at when we started to, when we made the decision to purchase this software, and we've gotten mixed reports. At this point, we've made the decision only to go back to January, and the reason for that is the information that you can input into IA Pro was not necessarily all of the information that we were capturing prior to. And so if we go back prior to January, we may not have the information, as much information to enter into IA Pro, and that could skew our numbers, and it could give us false or less accurate information in the reports and in our review. And so at this point, for that reason, we've decided just to start fresh with January 2017 and move forward.
And the reason I ask is I was thinking of the sort of the tickler file for supervisors of, hey, you have a particular officer who may have been involved in something. Not having that historical data sort of creates a false start point there.
Sure. We do have we have had an early warning system in place, so supervisors still have had access to that.
Okay.
That they have to go back and search. It's not quite as user-friendly, and it's not right at their fingertips as this will make it. So they have had that information available, and we have been tracking that. I think this will just give us that extra consistency and common area for documentation.
I think it's a fantastic tool to keep that professionalism and integrity throughout the department. So kudos to you. Any other questions?
Thank you.
Thank you. Is that that's the grand call? You don't even have a wrap-up statement or something, Chief?
We're just happy to be here.
There you go.
So are we.
Thank you.
Suzanne Hawkins.
Sorry, I have one question, just because this all makes me think. 3 years ago, maybe, we were given a presentation on a program the police department was implementing with maps, and it was correlating traffic accidents and crime. I've never heard anything again since then. Are we still doing that, or do we have... Just thought about that tonight.
Yes. Mayor and Councilwoman Hawkins and the rest of the council... So that's called DDAX, which Data-Driven Approach to Crime and Traffic Safety.
I couldn't remember.
We suspended that earlier last year because we were implementing a new records management system. So we will be getting back to that. We want to police smarter. So that is part of what we're going to do moving forward, yes.
Okay. Just thought of that tonight. Thanks.
Great question.
Any other questions? Well, once again, Chief, and to your entire team, thank you for the information tonight. I think that was a great update and hopefully a great opportunity for the public to better understand some of the initiatives that you all have going on to try to meet those mission statements and goals and keeping our community safe. Next on the agenda is another opportunity for public input. If there's anybody here wishing to address the council on any issues, now's your chance. Seeing no one, items from the city manager, Mr. Rothweiler.
Not this evening.
Anything from the council?
Forgot to turn on my light. I just want to send our thoughts and prayers to Doug Vollmer, who just lost his wife. Doug is a former mayor, and his wife, Deanna, fought a very long, hard battle with cancer. And I just think we just need to think about him. So.
Thank you, Ruth. Anything else from the council? Seeing none, last item then is adjournment to executive session under Idaho Code 742061F to communicate with legal counsel for the public agency to discuss the legal ramifications of and legal options for pending litigation or controversies not yet being litigated but imminently likely to be litigated. The mere presence of legal counsel at an executive session does not satisfy this requirement.
So moved.
Motion by Nikki Boyd, seconded by Suzanne Hawkins to adjourn into executive session.
Reminder, we will not be making any decisions in executive session, nor will we be reconvening the council meeting following the executive session. Any discussion? Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Sean Berger.
Yes.
Chris Talkington.
Yes.
Greg Lanting.
Yes.
Did he say yes?
Yes.
Christopher Reed.
Yes.
Ruth Pierce.
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins.
Yes.
Nikki Boyd.
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0. Meeting is adjourned.